Welcome to episode 118 of the UK Steelers podcast. You're joined by me, Sam Winstanley, and the three co-hosts, Rich Citrone, Gavin Marshall and Dave Hart, all here back together again. How's it going, guys?
Glad to be back together again as a foursome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's been a little while.
That's about the only positive thing I've got to say.
Well, I was going to say, it's nice because today what we're going to do, we've got a lot to talk about today. We've got a packed show. I'm going to go into excruciating detail, breaking down my Spotify Wrapped. And we're going to do that for the next hour and a half. Is that okay with everyone?
I think we've got to remember that, you know, this may be more interesting to the listeners than it is the enjoyment level we get out of doing it. So let's just crack on, shall we?
I feel like I had like a lot of people, because I had a lot of people contact me like straight after the game that was like, so, movie podcast this week? I was like, yeah. And then Gav sent me like a thing of him like, I'm going to watch the All-22. I was like, oh, Gav, why? Stop doing the job.
It's not as bad. When you watch back, it's not as bad. The emotion's gone. It's just, people just failing to do their job. Yeah, it's just tape. Unfortunately, it doesn't. Yeah.
That was a good tweet from Steelers Depot this week. It was women and children lie, tape don't lie.
Yeah, pretty miserable viewing.
So this week it does feel like the team really came apart at the seams a little bit following this game. The filling is kind of spilling out all over the place, all over the media. I've actually got news this week. Do you know what I might do news before the game recap. We've not done that in a while.
Let's do it.
All right, hit that horn, babe. Let's dance. All right, let's go. Steelers on three. 1, 2, 3, Steelers.
Yeah, well, it all starts to happen, right? As soon as the team senses that it's going down the pan, the cracks start to form and it all falls out. A few quick hitters first. Watt and Hager on the COVID list, right? So straight away, that's bad news for next week. Moose in concussion protocol. And we've signed Montravius Adams from the practice squad, a third-round pick from Green Bay a few years ago. Started three games since 2017. So a few quick hitters there, little things. But at the top, Watt and Hague is a bit of a nightmare because, obviously, we've seen what it's like when we don't have Watt on the field. And we're very light on offensive linemen, so I'm sure we'll talk about that when we get to the Ravens. Muth in concussion protocol is sad as well because he's one of the bright spots on this team, I think, one of the very few. But what I really wanted to talk about, and the reason I wanted to do news first, was because I'm sure I talked about this a couple of weeks ago. Tell me if I'm wrong, but didn't I say that once a season, someone gets dragged in to a conversation about whether to play music at practice, and it's either a good thing or a bad thing? I'm sure I said this the other week. And this year it's Chase Claypool. He's put a target on his own back this week. Asked what they can do to be more effective in practice, he said, put music on. So...
I really enjoyed Tomlin's response, which was Claypool plays wide out and I'll let him do that. I'll formulate the practice approach and I think that division of labour is probably appropriate.
That's a nuanced response from Mike Tomlin. I like that.
Madden, everyone's getting all up in arms about this and it's a bit of an overreaction. I mean, everyone's acting like they were never 23 and said something dumb. You know, it's everyone's done something dumb. I bet after he said it, he walked out and went, why did I just say play music? Why did I say that? It's just one of those stupid things that you probably, it comes to you and he's in a bit of a mood anyway because they just lost. And it's just come out of his mouth and he's not really thought about what he's saying.
You are, of course, right, Dave. But it speaks to a larger issue, I think, with Chase Claypool. And I think it's more, well, maybe it doesn't, but I think it's just come at a time where people, especially after the last game, are kind of starting to get a little bit done with the, I don't want to say the D word. What's another word? The dramatic side of Chase Claypool, should I say, and maybe not living up to what we know he can do with his physical abilities and stuff, and then the stuff on the field, you know, and he's ripping people's helmets off and he's getting called for dumb flags and then he's falling over his feet every time the ball goes up in the air when he should be going up and catching it. You know what I mean? It's just coming at a bad time. It's a bad look. That's why. I totally agree with what you're saying. I mean, it doesn't mean anything, obviously, but it's just, you know, if anyone was going to make the mistake this week, it was probably Chase Claypool.
What do you think, Rich? Music or practice?
Yeah, no, I liked Cam's response the best. I agree with Dave. He's young and he's going to say dumb things occasionally. And it just so happens that when he says something dumb, you know, the whole world's going to hear it. You know, we've all done it when we were that age, of course. But I think, you know, I think there is a problem. I think you know, I don't know if I'm sure you guys all heard Ryan Clark's rant, and I think he's dead on. You know, I think no one fears this team anymore. You know, there's not that intimidation factor the way there used to be, and I don't know if part of that is a result of how the rules have got so strict, you know, over the years about intimidation and things like that. And I don't know, but it's definitely an issue. You know, we don't strike fear into anybody, I don't think, anymore. I think we still try to be physical, but I think we have some players that aren't, maybe, you know, maybe aren't trying hard enough.
Yeah. I mean, you think back to last year, you had TJ, Tuit, Alu, you know, Cam, obviously, Vince Williams and Hilton. That was that defensive, you know, the fearsome front that they had. Most of that, you know, there's only Cam.
Yeah. Yeah. And Dupree too.
Right. Yeah. Right.
We don't have the bodies for sure that we had last year. I mean, look at our, even our back end, you know, like you said, Hilton and Nelson. I mean, I think we're starting to see how huge those losses were.
Yeah, I mean, I was, you know, not to go too far back and pump my own horn, but, you know, I was saying, let's keep Hilton, let's get rid of Sutton. And that's been my, you know, I've had my target on Sutton ever since, that they kept him over Hilton. And I think it showed up in this game. Although if you sort of, you know, read between the lines or whatever, it does seem like that was Hilton's best game of the season that he had against the Steelers.
Yeah, but I hope they didn't keep. I hope that's not what it was, because I agree. There's no way I would have. If you'd asked me back then, I said no way. I'd much rather have Hilton than Sutton. Is that really what it came down to? Do you know that?
No, I just think I think they could only keep one, and they were kind of the same price, weren't they? And there was a few sort of disagreements, arguments I got into on you know, various forums with people about who you should keep, and I seem to be in the minority saying that I wanted to keep Hilton. People saying, oh, he's so limited, he's just a blitz weapon or whatever. But I say, you know, it's part of the identity of the Steelers and it allows them to do so much. And, you know, Morlett's good. Don't get me wrong. I like what he does around the line of scrimmage, but I don't think he's that same blitz pressure as much as Hilton was.
Yeah, and it's, Hilton's thing has never been coverage. That's why it's kind of it's kind of funny. That's the best play on a ball I've ever seen him make. That, you know, that wasn't a defense against the run. He's always been fantastic against the run, but as far as playing the ball, that's the best play I've ever seen him make.
Yeah, there's another one. I'm just trying to find it in my notes here. I know we're not getting into that game yet, but there was another one where he carried. Was it Washington? Oh, it was Washington. He undercut on the route. There was another route he did. Oh yeah, it was Washington. Washington was doing a crosser, and Hilton took that play away, covered him like blanket coverage and took that away. I've never seen him do that either. So I don't know whether that was just him being hyped or whatever, but yeah, he was playing really well in coverage as well as the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, not great fun to see him running through the end zone in the first quarter as well. Yeah, we'll get to that in a sec. I just want to ask one more thing. I wanted to ask Rich about this because he's got a famous vendetta against Keith Butler. Deacon Kabbalah came out this week and said Keith Butler has never designed or called a defense in his entire time that he's been the defensive coordinator. Apparently she's like touted this for a while. It's the first time I've heard of it. I mean, I was reading an article about it on Steelers Depot, and he, you know, he holds the defensive play calling sheet, and he's the one speaking into Joe Schobert's helmet. So I'm a bit confused about what this means, that he doesn't call the defense. Who is calling the defense? Is it Mike Tomlin?
I mean, that makes him. It makes him out to be a cuckold.
Exactly.
Isn't it? Like he's. What's on that sheet? Nothing. Like a load of fake plays. And he's just pretending.
Like it's just like a coloring book you'd get from Applebee's.
Yeah. Or it's like a decoy, so that they can like lip read him and get the wrong play from the other sideline. I mean, what? Surely this can't be real, can it? He's never called a defensive play. What?
I literally have no idea. That's why I asked. I don't understand this report at all. I mean, Aditi Kunkabal has been on my radar a little bit the last few weeks, but I mean, if this is true, then it's a strange one.
I mean, what would that mean he was doing? Would that mean he's doing the personnel? So then what are the position coaches doing? It seems strange. Because Butler's been there for a long time. He's been part of the organisation, presumably. He could have gone elsewhere. They've locked him up for a long time. Why would he stay in this position where he's got no control? I don't know, man.
Yeah, I certainly wouldn't. I wouldn't want to be in that position. And if it is true, then Tomlin needs to, he needs to hire a coordinator that he feels confident in, and give it to him and have him do, have him do that job, because it's too much. Obviously, the mistakes that are being made out there, it's too much. If Tomlin's controlling things on defense, it's too much for his plate. You know, he has a hard enough time managing a game, making good decisions during the game as far as timeouts and things like that. He doesn't need any more on his plate.
No. Yeah, I'm not buying that story. Yeah. I read it and didn't. I just moved on. I didn't buy it.
Is he on his last legs at the minute? It seems like he's going to be the. I don't know if scapegoat is the right word. Maybe he's just the. Yeah, it feels like he's on thin ice at the moment.
He's been on thin ice for years, and he's still not fallen through it.
He's been on thin ice with some people. That's for sure. But
well, I got another one for you guys to check out when we start talking about the defense. This is just going to blow your minds. I don't know. Maybe you noticed it during the game, but it blew my mind. I just could not believe it.
Ah, jump into it. We can do it if you want. Let's go.
You do it right now?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it.
Okay. Do you guys remember the Charger game just 2 weeks ago when Justin Herbert was destroying us on the ground? And do you remember? I just came up with two possibilities to help prevent that. And if you remember, the first one was they're playing a cover two man, drop Edmonds down into the box, have him play a shallow zone in the middle, and he can spy Herbert. And the other one was, okay, you're rushing four the whole game, rush three, drop one back into a shallow zone in the middle and have him spy the quarterback. Mm-hmm. So what happens a week later when they're playing the Bengals? It's third quarter, 5 minutes left in the third quarter, third and 17. What does Butler do? He drops Highsmith back and rushes three and has him play that middle zone on a third and 17. Now, I know the Steelers, when they have numbers like that, they like to throw 2 yards down the field and just hope their guy's going to make an athletic play and get the 17 yards. But most teams don't do that. Most teams throw to the sticks, which is exactly what Burrow did. He threw it 16 yards. The guy was tackled immediately. They needed 1 yard. They got it on the next play with Mixon, got a yard on the fourth and one. So basically what you did was you nullified Highsmith in that moment. He did nothing on that play.
Yeah, he put him in no man's land.
But the point is, where was this play called last week when Herbert was destroying us on the ground? That's exactly what he should have done last week, and he didn't do it once or 2 weeks ago. Not one time did he run that defense. But the following week in a third and 17, he runs it? Like, I don't know, guys. Like, there's no rhyme or reason. Somebody please explain that to me. There's no rhyme or reason he should do that. But you know he was 1 week late. Okay, he was close. So yeah, I'm just so over him. I think he's done. To be honest with you, I don't see them. I think his contract's up this season, right?
All right. Okay.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. If they renew his contract, they deserve what they get, because he's just cannot make in-game decisions. I know I remember him playing. He was a pretty decent linebacker. He was all right, but I think he's a much better player than he was coach.
Can he still defend the run now? Should we get him out there?
Hey, it's worth a shot. You know what the heck? But yeah, I you know, guys, man, check out the play. If you can figure it out, what he was thinking and why he didn't use that defense last week. If anybody can that listens to the show, you know, please write into us, you know, and let us know, because it's a mystery to me.
Yeah, I think you're right. He must have been anticipating some kind of draw or a Burrow run, a Burrow scramble.
Yeah, because Burrow was killing us on the ground, right?
Yeah. I mean, but that's the only logical explanation, isn't it? Why would you take away? Yeah, it must have been the draw or some kind of thinking, oh, yeah, they're going to dump it off, because that's what we do, like you say.
Maybe this is what she means by him not calling the plays. He's actually got, like, an Xbox control, and it's like on Madden where he just pulls up the three suggested plays and he just clicks one of the buttons. So he's not thinking too deeply about it.
But, you know, you have to wonder, if he would have ran this defense on like, long third downs, you know, against the Chargers, would we have won that game? Because how many times did he kill us on third and long with his legs? I mean, it's possible we would have.
Yeah.
But he didn't. He didn't run it at all. He didn't make any adjustment like that at all to stop Herbert from running. So, I don't know. There you have it.
You're right on his contract, by the way. He's on a 1-year contract. I just looked it up.
Okay. I'm pretty sure he's done.
I'm not sure. I mean, how long did it take them, you know, when it was clear that Dick LeBeau's days were kind of done? He hung on for another 2 or 3 seasons, didn't he, at the end of his tenure?
A little bit more clout, though, you know?
Like, he's a legend, though.
Yeah.
I hear you.
They don't feel like an organization that's quick to move on. You know, Randy was 2 years overdue, was he? You know, at least a year too late. So, I don't know.
Yeah, well, they should have cut them both loose.
In good news, Matt Canada's already a year too late, so he's got a head start.
I don't know. I'm cutting Matt Canada a slack. Come on, let's. He's working with crumbs here.
I know. I joke. Okay, so as you know, I've been kind of documenting the game as it goes. That's what I do when the ads come on now, is I try and summarise the last drive, right? So I've been doing that over the last few weeks, and I got to about, let's see, what score was it? 31-3, and then I gave up. I stopped doing it. I turned red zone on, and I put this on at the side. I was like, I'm no longer tracking every drive of this because it's no longer relevant, and I just wrote down the scores. So, I mean, this game just started as a disaster and it never got any better, really, did it? First drive was just mix and gashing us, really, with a couple penalties thrown in, including a PI on Sutton. Burrow runs it from 10 yards out and beats Minka at the goal line, a tackle that I think Minka has to make, to be honest, to get in 7-0. Then Ben throws his first pick in 5 weeks, throws behind Claypool. I think it's probably a miscommunication somewhere, probably on Claypool, if we're honest.
Third offensive play. Yeah, the Steelers game. Yeah. I mean,
and Eli Apple of all people returns it to the 4-yard line. In fairness to the defense, they do hold up there. They get a sack and then push them back, and it's 10-0. Ben comes out and throws a deep lob straight to Claypool for a contested catch, which was nice. But then it was followed up by a illegal formation and a 1-yard Snell run, which I enjoyed. But we did manage a 40-yard field goal, just that's 10-3. And then it just collapsed. T. Higgins beat James Pierre easily on a deep contested catch. It was one of the worst defended balls you'll see. 17-3. After a couple of trading possessions, the Bengals use up most of the second quarter running the ball again. Mixon scores 24-3. And then Minka gets the pick on Burrow. So at least that's something nice for us. And then I just gave up at that point. It was 31-3. Muth scored a touchdown in garbage time. It ended 41-10. I tend to go to Rafer Tapaldo. You know, he does the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. He does, like, grades for each position. I tend to read that on a Monday morning. He gave everyone an F except the receivers, who got a D this week.
Seems fair. Yeah.
So I don't know where you want to start, but yeah.
Well, I sort of was wondering where this game ranks in Steelers versus Bengals rivalry. Turns out this is the biggest beatdown for either team in 105 meetings. Going back to the merger. So this is the biggest points differential. And thank God they got that Muth touchdown, or this would have been, you know, one for the ages. And also another depressing stat, it's the first time the Bengals have beaten the Steelers 3 times in a row since 1990. So this is new lows in the rivalry, division rivalry, whatever, you know. It's like, oh, bad times. 105 games, the biggest beatdown. I was getting into the 70s, thinking surely there's got to be a bigger upset. There was a couple of sort of 30-10s. Nothing this big.
If it wasn't for the touchdown, it would have been Ben's worst loss of his career, apparently. So, I mean, can you remember a worse loss? I don't know. I mean, Rich, you probably remember a lot more than we do. Or at least I do.
I've seen a lot of games, and I have a lot on video. I think I have every one of their games since, like, 2004.
Wow.
But I'd have to look through them. I honestly can't remember one this bad. It's just, yeah, it's difficult to keep the TV on.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, sorry, Dave.
We have to give some credit, I think, to the Bengals in all this. I mean, we can kick ourselves when we're down as much as we want and wallow in our own self-pity, but we're only a season or so removed from the guy who spent the season on his roof waiting for a win. Remember that? He wouldn't come down from his roof. until the Bengals won a game. And I think he's stayed up there till like week,
he's,
I don't know, week 15 or something. But yeah, no, they've done a hell of a job getting that team back on a on some sort of track. And hey, good for them. And you know, I'm hoping at some point in the future we can remind them where this rivalry actually lies. You know, but no, they've done well with that team, and they've finally gotten something out of it. You know, they've drafted well, and they've got a QB that's going to hang around and not just be a bum for a while. You know, I don't know. I can't help but feel good for the Bengals in some sort of weird masochistic way.
Again, though, with the Bengals, I do, because I agree with what you're saying, Dave. We have to give credit to the Bengals. They have built a nice team. They've drafted well, like you say, and they're a scary offense, especially. But yeah. The Bengals fans again just don't know how to win. Listen, we've lost to we haven't lost to the Browns this year, or the Ravens. So maybe we'll see. But whenever we lose to the Browns or Ravens, I don't really get this from them. But as soon as the Bengals start to take a lead over the Steelers, I'm getting quote tweets, I'm getting Bengals fans in my mentions, you know, people are reveling over my my sad tweets, making me look a fool. I don't appreciate it. Classless.
Well, they're punching up, you know.
Well, yeah.
When they're on the same level with the same history, then we'll talk.
Anyway, I had to get that out. I know I've said this a few times this season, but Bengals fans on my radar as well.
One scary fact, the Bengals season long are 20th in rushing yards per attempt with 4.1 yards per attempt. They weren't averaging 4.1 against the Steelers, I'll tell you that much. The Steelers are fourth worst in the league with 3.7.
With Najee Harris?
Behind only the Texans, the Dolphins and the Falcons, three storied franchises. And they're sixth worst in the league of passing yards per attempt. So this is a bad offense. But we knew that anyway, right?
Yeah.
Ravens, by the way, ninth in the league with 4.6. Look, you know, buckle up for that one. That's going to be fun.
A team that lost all of its running backs in the preseason. Yeah. This season.
I mean, I just wanted to walk you through second quarter. The Bengals go on a 14-play, 7.5-minute drive. Right, I just wrote down, because this is when I was watching the All-22 the other night, and I just could not believe the game book. I had to sort of, I did a double take at it. Right, I skipped one no gain for a no play, nonsense play. But this is how it went. 11-yard pass, 4-yard run. Sack, hooray. 16-yard deep pass to Higgins, 5-yard run. Incompletion, 7-yard pass, 9-yard run. 8-yard run, 9-yard run, 9-yard run, 5-yard run, 1-yard touchdown. I mean, they're just getting practically first downs with every attempt, pretty much, on the ground. I mean, that is unacceptable for this team and shocking and needs to change drastically, but I don't know how it's going to, because, I mean, for just a lack of physicality up front and from the linebackers was sickening to my stomach, and I'm sure it is for every Steeler fan out there. Horrible.
Yeah. And it wasn't until you made... sorry, I can't remember who said it now, but you were talking about earlier about all the guys we lost in the off-season. I never even thought about it like that. You know, those were the guys with the juice. Those were the guys with the attitude. And when they leave independently, you think, well, we can survive without Mike Hilton. We can survive without Bud Dupree. You know, we can survive without X, Y, and Z. But when you put that together and you look at who's left, it's not a scary defense. And when we played the Chargers and you thought, well, you know, we're missing Wharton, we're missing Minka, and you make all these excuses, we're missing Hayden. There was no excuse today, you know. I don't care whether Hayden's out. You know, I know I've been saying that Joe Hayden's the Jenga piece for a long time because the secondary, I was so worried about the rest of the secondary, but you can't go out and into a season with your second and third cornerbacks being complete liabilities and expect to go anywhere. So it's bad team building on defense. It's razor thin. There's stars at the top, but the depth is poor, man. You only need to look at the D-line, you know. Tuitt's out and Alulu's out and all of a sudden there's just nothing. We're losing the line of scrimmage on offense and defense, and you're never, ever, ever going to win in the NFL like that consistently.
Well, to be fair, I mean, I challenge how many teams could lose, you know, that quality up front and still back it up. The problem is they haven't got the run support behind from the linebackers. Mm. That's the problem. So it's everything's exposed.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to weather injuries. Every team struggles with injuries. That's just part of the sport. But yeah, like you say, it's team building. The team building. It's like on the O-line, same thing. You know, we're playing with backups to start with. So when they go down, you're at sort of street free agent level I mean, no team's going to have success with that kind of unit. You know, I'm really unfortunate. I mean, the O-line has been improving, but the only reason it had been improving because it was a consistent unit. Suddenly they've lost Dotson. You know, now they've lost Haig. You know, the pieces that they had that were growing together, it's now lost and it's all fallen apart and it looked awful.
It doesn't make for good listening, does it? Dave, find me a positive.
Come back to me. I can't find one, man. There's very little. I think I felt we've said it before, but there's nothing to really get from this game.
Yeah.
You know, it's just put it in the book and hope that doesn't happen again. It's embarrassing, man. Even living in the UK, because like you see the odd NFL fan around, right? You sort of see a jersey here and there or a hat or something. I'm obviously not living in the US, you don't have the same sort of issue of people gloating, but you find yourself sort of shying away a little bit after that, sort of hiding the hat you're wearing a little bit.
Not the shame.
No. Wear it, pride, Dave.
No, you still wear it, but you just sort of you don't make eye contact with fellow NFL fans anymore. You just sort of look at them and keep walk a bit faster afterwards, you know.
Lucky my buddy Luke at work's a Cowboys fan, so he's in the same boat of shame at the moment, so it's fine. Yeah.
I just don't see any way that this defense, the way it's currently constructed, and I forgot to talk about Tua at the top in the news, Rich, but we'll mention that in a second. I don't see how we stop any running back. Any team that has a reasonable running game is just going to traipse all over us, because like you said, I mean, Bush and Schobert we need to talk about those two. But Joe Mixon goes for 165 yards on 28 attempts in this game. Just runs right down our throat all game. There's nothing we could do to stop it because Cam Hayward's playing nose tackle for some inexplicable reason. Isaiah Bugs is a healthy scratch. I have no idea what's going on there. And
it feels like shooting yourself in the face. Why did they do that? I mean, it must be, I don't know what he's done. He's missed a practice, turn up drunk. I don't know. So he's done something, right? Because it was must have been behaviour. But he's let the team down. You know, it's not like the team of Tomlin or whoever it was. Obviously, clearly felt like that decision had to be made to teach him a lesson, but it really hurt the team.
Yeah. Yeah, because Wormley and Mondo just weren't going to get it done. And
but, I mean, they're fine backups, but not when they're starting. I mean,
yeah. Well, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I did want to just mention this Tuit stuff. I think you spotted it, Rich. That someone was reporting that he's maybe over the knee injury, right? And potentially isn't going to play this year because he's not in the right headspace after the death of his brother. Is that right?
I read that from Dale Lawley. He's a media guy in Pittsburgh, and supposedly he has this information that his knee's healed. He's fine physically. He's just still distraught over his brother's death. And we talked about that all throughout the year, that was definitely a possibility. I personally didn't think he would play the entire season because it's just really honestly because I've watched this team for so long, for so many years, and you get used to a way things are done. You know, you get used to when a guy gets hurt, you get used to what the reports sound like.
Yeah.
And this was weird from the beginning. You know, it just, we knew about his brother's death. You know, that's going to affect you, you know, the player, of course. But it never got, he never seemed to heal from it as the season went out. And the information coming in was just really strange and cryptic. And I thought, nah, this is much more than an injury. So who knows, guys? I mean, who knows if he's done with football? You know, he's 14 million against the cap next year?
Mm.
So, man, there's a lot of decisions for the Steelers in the offseason. It's going to be a real wild ride, I think, in the offseason.
Yeah.
I mean, grief is a process, right? It's a process, right? You can't just rush your way through it. But I have to imagine there's guys within the organization that are speaking to him and, like, would it be counseling or something that you'd be receiving? I don't know, that sort of helping him through that. I can't imagine they're just sort of leaving him to his own devices and hoping that he's just going to feel better after a while. You know, he's going to be receiving some help from the organization themselves.
But I mean, look at Calvin Ridley with the Falcons. I mean, there's no clear trigger there. He's just stepped away from the game. I think you have to respect that. You know?
Yeah.
till he's ready to play. He's not ready to play.
Is this a new thing? Have we ever? Because to me, this is new. I mean, I know obviously these things are becoming more like socially acceptable to talk about, right? Which is good. But have you've been watching football longer than me? Have we ever seen anything like this in the past where guys have just walked away like Calvin Ridley? And because
not to this degree. No. This just seems like there's too much of it that's happening.
We had the when the CTE thing first started, you had a few players suddenly retiring, didn't you, out of fears. Like you had the I can't remember his name now, but you had the 49ers linebacker who was quite fresh into his career, and he's and on the Steelers, I mean, Jason Worrell's retirement was quite surprising, wasn't it? But aside from that.
But those are like retirements for, you know, for a reason or a concern. I think Worrell was, didn't he go to do like a religious thing?
Yeah, he wanted to be a pastor, didn't he?
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, this is more like just stepping away from the game, either temporarily or because of, yeah, I mean, it's interesting, that's all, but it's a different trend that, you know, teams are going to have to deal with as time goes on, I suppose. So yeah, that's the D line. So that's one position. Jot that down in your notebooks for the draft and the off season to try and find about three guys to fill those spots. We got to talk middle linebacker. We'll start with Devin Bush. Just came out as he was last week, just absolutely awful. He was removed, benched, I think, pretty much after an offside on the first drive. Then came back in because Spillane injured his knee. Now, he's public enemy number one. I was talking about this. When I went on the Ravens podcast the other day, I was talking about Devin Bush a little bit. And I was saying how he is, at this point, public enemy number one in Pittsburgh. It feels like to me, anyway. If you go online, it's just Devin Bush talk 24/7. Mm. But then you see Vince Williams, and a few players did this, but Vince Williams was the loudest, came out and defended him in a series of Twitter threads, and I'll read a little bit of it. Devin Bush is coming off a major injury. His coach's wife died, and he's missing two of his starting linemen. People called Bud Dupree a bust, and then begged him to take a hometown discount to stay. By the way, Devin Bush is 23 years old. If he plays at least 30, that's 7 years to turn his career around. Devin's game is always centered around explosion and power. It takes an athlete 8 to 12 months just to get back from an ACL. It's going to take at least double that to get back to the high level of cutting and exploding that's needed to look like a top 10 pick. This isn't even considering the psychological issues he must overcome, nor does it take into account the lost reps and experience he's missed while nursing the injury. And he goes on and on. But what do you think of that as a kind of defence of Devin Bush? And are we too quick to give up on him, do you think? And what are you seeing out of him?
I mean, I don't think they should give up on him. I think they should keep him around. But I think, you know, hanging your hat on Bush is not, at this point, is not going to be a successful strategy, because he is a liability out there at this point. And I think he needs to be benched, and hopefully Spillane can come in. And I don't know, let's get Buddy Johnson some snaps. Let's do something. Let's get Bush off the field, get him right, and try and work him back in. Because at the moment, he's overcorrecting himself. He's not playing hard enough. There's questions over his effort. I mean, I never want to call effort into a play, but there does seem to be things where he's not pursuing as well as he should be. I mean, I've never written so many notes on a guy after a game as I have. I mean, it's just a whole paragraph here of things that he's done wrong in the game. I don't even want to go into it. I mean, it's just so many, like, missed tackles, unsuccessful, you know, not getting off blocks, over-pursuing, under-pursuing, just slow, you know, not reading, not reacting. I mean, just everything that a linebacker is asked to do, he wasn't doing it. So changes needed to come in. I mean, Tomlin said that, right? Changes to come in. So I think that would be the most obvious change.
Yeah.
You're right, Gavin. I mean, if this is the case, and it's a result of injuries, etc., then why are they still putting that load on him? Why is he still the guy? Surely they realise that by now, that if he's the guy that we thought he was, but he's just not showing it, why are they expecting him to suddenly just turn it round, you know, mid-game and just become the guy again? Do you know what I mean? He's not Superman. It's not going to happen all of a sudden. It's going to take time for him to go through that recovery process. It's, like you say, just split his workload with other guys. Spell, you know, maybe have him be in the spell, be the guy that he's used to spell other guys for a while. But I mean, is Spillane, I know he's on the injury report, is he looking,
he's got a knee sprain
for a return?
He's got a knee sprain, so I'm not sure if that, it could be out this week at least.
Not that's what they're going to do. I have no shadow of a doubt that they're going to keep plugging away with the Devin Bush train. But it would make a whole lot of sense if it is the case that it's a result of the injuries, etc., to have him, you know, share his workload even more with those other guys around him. Like I said, Buddy Johnson, give him a chance. He's not played a snap here. Right? Did we see him in preseason even?
He did get some preseason. Yeah.
Just give the guy a chance. Especially, you know, nothing's working now. We've got to start throwing stuff at the wall and see what sticks, you know?
Yeah, that's a good point there. What is the attitude now on a grander scale for the rest of the season? Because playoffs are now looking like a very distant... Yeah, exactly right. What's the attitude for the rest of the season? What are we trying to get out of it? What do we want to know? What do we, you know, where are we going from here? Because I'm seeing tanking tweets. You know, I mean, Steelers Twitter tends to implode at the tiniest thing anyway, but, you know, in the last two games, things have definitely collapsed in terms of this season. I don't think anyone thinks that we're making a playoff push.
Yeah, I mean, it's something I wanted to bring up when we got onto the cornerbacks, but I was surprised that Pierre stayed on the field as long as he did.
Yeah.
And I would just, whether it's loyalty, whether they just seem slow to make changes, be it to the scheme or to the personnel. And I just wonder why they're not trying to work some of these youngsters in. Why, when the game was in garbage time, why did we not see some switches out? Tomlin said, yeah, Witherspoon came in to replace. It was like for like 1.5 drives. I mean, it was nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, if it was me, the game was out of hand. Let's get Witherspoon out there because Higgins was just absolutely dominating Pierre on every single snap. Well, you know, I like Pierre. I'm not writing Pierre off by any means. He did make one hell of a nice play when he was tight on man, and that was after he'd made all his mistakes. But most of the when Higgins was up against him, he was losing. And then Witherspoon came in and made a nice play right at the end. Made a nice pass break up and, you know, high five with Tomlin. And you know, I think maybe we'll see a bit more Witherspoon this week. But it just seems so slow to react. I mean, Rich, what do you think? Do you think they should be swapping out personnel a bit quicker than they are?
Yeah, I think so. I think you're right. Pierre was just getting worked, and if not anything for any other reason, but to not damage his confidence too much. Because I like the kid, and I think he can be a good corner one day. But he did not have a good game, and you know, when you talked about Witherspoon, I believe besides the interceptions, that was the only pass contested by any of our DBs the entire game. I think that's the only one. Every other pass was either thrown poorly and it couldn't be caught, or it was a reception. We were never in a position to bat any passes down until Witherspoon did it right at the end of the game. And that says a lot about how our coverage is on the back end right now. So I agree. I think they should be doing that on all positions at that point in the game, especially get the kids in there and get them some work. You might find that you have something, you know, you didn't expect. You know, some players, they're not practice players. You know, some players are. They are awesome in practice, and in a game, they just can't put it together. But there's some players that just aren't good practice players, and you put them in the limelight, and they shine. And you know, let's see if we have any of those guys.
Yeah, totally. And it goes to roster construction, like you were talking about earlier, Si. I mean, you take Hayden out, and what does the cornerback group really have? Not much.
No, yeah. The secondary has concerned me for a long time. Like, if you remember, before the season started, I maybe foolishly, but I said that the secondary was my biggest concern in front of the O-line, because I was just so worried about everything behind Joe Hayden. And, you know, I like Pierre, right? But I've always said I just don't think he's ready to be starting on the outside, so...
Well, this secondary peaked in week one, right?
That was a good game.
it hit its ceiling and it's just rebounded off it ever since.
Yeah.
But with Pierre, the thing that concerned me is, like, I think the thing that a lot of people like, I mean, he's a physical kind of guy, isn't he? He showed almost no physicality at all at times. He just sort of, maybe whether that's a technique or some technique thing or something, maybe just being out.
I think he was being bullied by T. I mean, he's a big dude, you know, that's a big receiver. That's like a Chase Claypool like type of, you know, size.
I mean, yeah, and he's a perimeter guy. He's a boundary, big, you know, twin towers type guy. You know, just catch point. But
but great at getting separation. So Pierre was really getting, that was a real stiff test for him. So I'm not writing off Pierre at all. I mean, but he was giving up hella separation. And that's the problem. So then he's trying to recover against a guy that's taller than him with a bigger arm and has got better jump skills than him. So he's trying to recover against someone that's going to beat him at the catch point, even if he's already in phase of him and he wasn't in phase of him. So it was a really, really stiff test. And that's why I think Witherspoon could have come in, because he's a big, rangy guy and could have covered him a bit better. But, you know, I just wonder, is it, you know, Tomlin's next man up philosophy? You know, you don't bring in the next man until the guy that's at the top of the depth chart has lost his job, and then the next man comes in and he's got it until he loses it. So it's more of a, you're not flip-flopping constantly, you know, one bad play, you're out, next guy in. It's like it's yours until you've really lost it. And I can kind of respect that as well, to a degree, but it's hard to sort of watch when it's going so bad.
You know, you look at that first touchdown against Pierre that Higgins got, it was good coverage. He was right there with him. The difference was, He made a really poor play on the ball. You know, he mistimed his jump, and Higgins just looked completely in control of that whole situation when it got to that point where the ball was, you know, coming down to both of them. And he made a really bad play, but his body position was pretty freaking good. There really wasn't, you know, a separation between the two.
Yeah, that is definitely outskilled at the catch point on that one. But then some of the later ones, he got into his head. Higgins was in his head by that point and was just double moving him and all sorts. It was, yeah. I feel sorry for him, to be honest, because it's, you don't want your young guys getting beaten like that repeatedly. It's not good for them, right? Like you said, it's bad for their confidence.
It's demoralising. I thought one of you, I thought you might want to talk about how well, because you've got to give credit to the Bengals for just neutralising TJ Watt in this game. Now, maybe there was a lingering injury thing going on, I don't know, but I haven't seen TJ neutralised like that almost ever.
I don't think he was himself.
Yeah.
No.
To be honest. I think the COVID thing maybe will help him get better. I don't want to see him like that, because the one thing that you can rely on TJ for, even if he's not getting pressure to the quarterback, is he does that backside pursuit in the run game, you know? Yeah. And he wasn't doing it. Like, he just couldn't. He was a step late.
I don't think he was really ready to play, but I think he just wanted to play so bad he you know, forced himself into the lineup. But he did not look 100%. His burst wasn't there. You're right. His pursuit wasn't there. His strength wasn't there. He looked like 50% of his normal self.
They weren't even double teaming him after a while. They stopped. You know, I mean, that speaks volumes, right? They moved the double teams over to Cam, and he couldn't even win. So, yeah, I just think he wasn't ready.
Yeah, because even in games where the Steelers have been trashed on defense, TJ usually comes up with a play or two, right? At the very least. So, yeah, shocking to see that. But like you say, probably not all the way back. That Highsmith almost interception was entertaining, at least. He juggled that for about 10 seconds in the air. That was interesting. Maybe he wants to spend some time with DJ, catching those tennis balls. Just in case that happens again.
Join the circus, man.
I felt bad for him, man. That's a play that he just shouldn't have to make, but you kind of hope that he does. I didn't see a great deal out of Highsmith in this game, to be honest. I thought he showed up a little bit later on in garbage time, got into the backfield, but there wasn't a great deal of pressure on Burrow from anywhere, to be honest, outside of Cam desperately trying up the middle. So that's the defense. 82 points given up in the last 2 weeks. Anyone else you want to highlight that we haven't spoke about?
Well, I think it's in this game, I thought Morlett, I mean, he looks clumsy in coverage, but I think he's probably the best run defender outside of Cam in this game. And I think deserves credit. I mean, he was making plays, you know, he got the pressure in the first quarter for the red zone sack, which forced a field goal. He's still making plays against around the, you know, down the line of scrimmage in the fourth quarter, a couple of nice tackles there. So I think, you know, Morlett can stay. I think I like Morlett, you know, yeah. It's just the rest of the unit. I wanted to talk a bit more about linebackers, because we're sort of killing the linebacker unit. All right, so where are we with Schobert? I mean,
he's so strange, because every week he finishes with the most tackles, but yet he doesn't show up in the run game, right? He never seems to be there making impact plays or filling the gaps, or, you know what I mean? I mean, these tackles are coming, but they're not I don't feel like they're impacting the run game at all.
I think his gap discipline is pretty good. His gap game's good, but just he's not the most physical guy. He doesn't necessarily finish so strong. He's not like a fearsome presence like we're talking about, you know, with Vince Williams or whatever. But, you know, I think as a complimentary piece, I like him. But, I mean, I guess my question is what kind of linebacker do the Steelers need? I mean, is it just the loss of Vince Williams? Is that what's killing, you know, like we're looking at like Patrick Queen this week. He's like, you know, Vince Williams kind of clone is looking like all he can be right now. You know, good round the line of scrimmage, good pass rusher, pressure, blitzer, not much else. Physical presence. Is that what they're lacking? Is that, you know, because they're 10 a penny in the draft.
Yeah.
Is there a street guy that is out there that they could bring in? Or is it something else? Is it something more? Is it a coverage guy they need? Is it, I don't know, is it an athlete back there? Is it a...
I mean, to me, it comes down to a fear thing. Like we were talking about earlier, no one's scared of this defense right now. And Vince Williams, for all his faults, was a fearsome guy. He was a thumper. He delivered the word, man. And it's something that's not there right now. We're just talking about Devin Bush not sort of whiffing on tackles and not being able to just sort of misreading and over pursuing, under pursuing, and what have you. And there's no one on this, particularly when it comes to linebackers, no one that's really being that fearsome guy. I mean, we had like the likes of James Harrison in years gone by. I know he's in a different kind of position, but someone that people, you know, the offenses look at and go, God, like, that guy's scary, man. I want to stay away from him. Or we've got TJ, but there's not when it comes to middle, there's not the guy there that's just going to be the guy who you're scared of and you want to get away from, you know?
I think it depends what's around them as well. Like, I think if the D-line was at full health, you know, if you had Tua and Alu-Alu and Calm up front, maybe it wouldn't matter as much that we didn't have a thumping linebacker behind them, you know what I mean? But now that this D-line is so thin and so, you know, so just wet paper blanket, you want a guy there that's ready to come downhill and deliver the hit, and we just don't have that either now. So all of a sudden you've got, you know, you get into like Edmonds before you've got anyone that you kind of trust to lay a hit.
Think of one play of a linebacker blitz where a linebacker's like lanced through the line and has got a sack or got a pressure or blown up a tackle in the backfield this season? Can you?
Last week that big fourth down that Schobert hit that gap full speed and stopped what's his name, Eckert.
At the hole though, right? At the line of scrimmage.
Or 1 yard behind, I'm not sure. Okay. But it was fourth and one, I think it was, something like that. And he just stuffed it. I mean, he hit the gap fast and just stuffed him. I mean, that's the closest to what you're asking I can think of.
There was a few occasions in this game where Schobert was getting into the backfield. He just wasn't in the right area at the right time. I think even the commentators have mentioned it, that he was, you know, he made the right play, it just didn't go in his direction, you know.
Yeah, I don't see any pass rush from these guys. That's what I'm kind of getting at. But
yeah,
no, it makes you it definitely makes you appreciate. I know, Gav, you always liked Williams, and it definitely makes you appreciate Williams now for sure, because he's one of the pieces that we desperately need on this team because of his attitude, because of his hitting prowess, because of his ability to rush the quarterback as well. And he fills the holes quickly and well. He just didn't have that athleticism that we were looking for when we drafted Bush. And that's, you know, I think that's what everyone hoped Bush would become, Williams, but more athletic and able to cover the pass. And that would have been awesome, but we don't have that. We don't even have Williams, you know, with Bush. So
yeah, I guess Williams didn't do this team any favors by retiring after the draft and after free agency, but before training camp, right? That was a really unfriendly. I don't know what the reasons were. Maybe, you know, we talked about it at the time. Maybe it was, you know, he turned up and he just didn't feel right. Whatever, you know, I'm sure he didn't want to retire, but whatever it was, that timing really hurt the team. And because in the draft, one of the easier things to evaluate is, can a linebacker rush the passer? Is he physical? That's on tape. And that translates. Like, if a guy's doing that in college, he's probably, you know, look at Michael Parsons. Michael Parsons was rushing the passer in college, and lo and behold, he's doing it in the NFL, and it works. It's the intangible things at the linebacker position that are hard to evaluate. Will the guy be able to read and react? Will he be able to read in coverage? And you know, can he do the more nuanced things of the position? And that's why they went up to get Bush, because he seemed like the guy. He was like a safe bet, rather than like who was the next best linebacker in that draft, Jermaine Pratt, ironically, of the Bengals. But you know, what they should have this guy. They should have a guy that they can bring on, a thumper, to fill in. And if Buddy Johnson isn't that guy, I mean, is this a result of the Steelers having so few draft picks the last couple of years? They've just not had. They've not brought in this sort of influx of quality youth. They're relying on nobody's, you know, with the most amount of respect, but kind of street level guys coming in to be the backups. So is that what we're looking at here? It's just the end of Ben's contract and the lack of draft picks compensating for trying to move up to get players, to get the blue chip players, and now we're at the end of the run and everything's collapsing. And this is, we're seeing it across multiple position groups. You reap what you sow. We are reaping it right now.
That sigh says it all, doesn't it? This defense has made me so sad.
I mean, this was a good defense. This was a great defense last year, and a good defense at times this season. Surely this is the low, right? This is, if this was a company and it was floated on the stock exchange, you would buy now, right? Because you buy the dip. So hopefully this is going to rebound, and we'll see new highs.
Well, this is the frustrating thing about this team, right? I mean, not that I'm going to be jumping ship anytime soon, but it's the frustrating thing about this team that, look to, what year was it? When Lev Bell was around, you had the Killer Bees. And you go, imagine if we had a defense, man. This would be an amazing team. And it still was. It still was a great team. It just didn't have the defense backing it up. And then last season, the season before, we had this great defense that was in, top 10 defense. And now we've got, it'd be good to have anything right
now.
We haven't got an offense or a defense right
now. We have Chris Boswell.
What do we do?
got Mars Killebrew on special teams. Yeah. Yeah. He didn't show up this week, by the way, either. Everyone let us down.
You want to know the middle linebackers' PFF grades? Devin Bush got a 25, and Joe Schobert got a 30. So that's good. Hey, but Minka got his first pick, right? Minka got his first pick, so there's something to celebrate.
One of the better games this season for Minka, I thought.
Yeah, he's got a really high rate. He's got 90 PFF rating, so there you go.
90?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
How much does the pick sway that? Does that have a big sway on it?
I don't know. I'm not sure. But
is he leading the team in tackles, Minka, for the season?
I think Schobert is, but I'm not 100%. Maybe, I can probably find that if you give me 2 seconds.
Yeah, it's not great when your safety is the leading tackler, is it? Your free safety. It's not a great sign.
That's never a good sign on any defense.
Ramping a bit more? No? You ready?
Nope, not yet.
Okay.
You know, when you think...
Yeah, I've got it, sorry. Schobert's got 78 combined, 50 solo, and Minka's got 72, 49 solo. So he's close.
Pretty close.
Okay. Yeah,
I'm going to do that thing again because I drank my can of Monster too quick. Do you want to move on to the offense, and you can start wherever you like, and then I'll come back in 2 seconds.
Okay. Well, the obvious place is to start with Ben. I mean, this was is this it? Like, are we done with Ben? I mean, people are sort of saying, national media, fantasy people. People outside of Steelers, Twitterverse, whatever, are saying he's done, right? Like, if there was any questions before, now he's definitely done. The mobility's gone, and it's hard to argue with that. I mean, when he tried to step up in the pocket on the, he tried to escape, he just looks so heavy footed. He's making a million steps where three would do. He just looks so heavy. But also, he's hesitant. He's And this might be a result of playing behind a bad O-line, but he's almost like seeing ghosts. He's reacting to pressure that isn't there.
The double pumps, you know, just hesitancy. The mix up with Claypool. I mean, it looks to me like that was on Ben. I mean, when he threw the 41 yard deep shot to Claypool, which was a great completion, it looked like he was throwing a javelin. I mean, he put absolutely everything into that throw. And then snatching at the quick outs, which, you know, last season the quick outs were his game, but this season they're just singing. Or And then the decisions, whatever reason, you mentioned it before, Rich, throwing the checkdowns on 3rd and 10, you know, it's like throwing behind the sticks and asking your guy to try and beat 3 defenders to get the first down. I don't know, man.
For me, and the question isn't, are we done with Ben? Is it should Ben be done with the Steelers? Should he be more self-aware of his limitations and on how he's affecting this team, you know, because he hasn't, I mean, he obviously didn't know this before the season started, but he hasn't got the defense to back him up at the moment and might not have it for the rest of the season. It's looking that way anyway. You know, should he have had more self-awareness of, I'm another year older, I'm another year slower, I'm not the guy that they drafted way back when, I'm a very different kind of guy and I'm not feeling great. But at the same time, athletes, they're not to put it in a bad way, but they're egotists, right? They want to believe that they're still the guy. They want to still believe that they've still got it in the tank. But to me, he should have thought to himself, do I need to come back for another year to prove something? What was he hoping to prove without an O-line and without a... I don't know. Should he have been more self-aware of his limitations?
I don't know. It's hard to say. Calling it a day is such a massive decision. I don't know.
It is. But at the same time, I'd like to think that when I'm ready to give up on something, I know that it's time to do it. You know, I don't just keep plugging ahead, hoping that it's sudden, you know, things will go back to how they were. You just sort of think, yeah, it's time. It's time to. And I mean, for all, you know, I know for me, I probably won't be a Steelers fan without Ben. He was a big part of what attracted me to this team, to be a fan of this team. And is this how everyone wanted the Big Ben era to end? I don't know.
No, we wanted a Super Bowl last year. That's what we wanted.
I would have been happy with the last season of the Big Ben era being a non-losing season, an 8-8 season, and just being competitive, being a team that was in it and amongst it, and not just flopping out of a half-assed game with the Bengals. I wanted to. You know, everyone wants to see a team that's competitive, not just someone who's going to half-arse it. You know, and that's not what. It makes me sad for the end of the Big Ben era, because it is the end of the Big Ben era. I think this is the last season, man.
I think when you think about franchise quarterback retirements, generally, unless they can retire off in the sunset like Peyton Manning, most of them, it's a sad ending when it's clear that the game has passed them by and they're not ready for it. But
I suppose, but it's exacerbated by the fact that the Steelers are so loyal. They're so loyal to him. Look, you know,
is it loyalty, or is it just that we don't have another option? Like, you know, like, yeah, what are we going to do? Play Mason? Well. You know, I don't know. I probably missed the start of what you've said here because I got back. But is this you kind of saying that Ben should have retired last off season?
Sort of, just more him being self aware and realizing that it was the end, it was his time, and he should have put his hand up.
Because
I was saying the national media is basically saying he's done.
Yeah,
right?
They are. Yeah, because they asked me this exact question on the Ravens podcast this week. They were talking about should Ben have come back and what's Ben's play been like this year, and I kind of defended Ben because after what I saw in that charge, and this was after the Bengals game, by the way. Anyway, after what I saw in that Chargers game, I'm struggling to be too critical of Ben. Now, this wasn't a good game from him. There was a lot of errant throws there, and you know. The picks weren't great, although one of them might have been a miscommunication. But either way, neither of those balls should have been thrown. But, I mean, has Ben really been the reason this team's losing week after week? You know, I mean, I said on the Raven show, I was like, Ben is better now than Peyton Manning was when he won his last Super Bowl. You know, I have no doubt that Ben could win a Super Bowl with a very good team around him. It's just not this team. And
what has Ben got at this point? I'd say his grit and his experience are what makes him a viable QB.
And he's still got some of those magic throws are still there. Now, they're not there at the same rate that they used to be, and they're not coming downfield as much as we'd like. But you still see him thread the needle on some of these passes to DJ that just leave you thinking nobody else could do that, you know.
But it is the playbook is limited because of him. And I was saying why you weren't here. I was saying, you know, it's clear that he is getting affected by the O line, the amount of pressure he's getting, and the fact he has to get the ball out so quick.
Yeah, absolutely. I just think especially after what I saw in the fourth quarter of that Chargers game. I got a lot of respect for Ben this season after, you know, that was just a very gritty performance to even bring us back to where we were in that game. And I struggled to be too critical of him after that, you know, until he starts coming out here and just absolutely waxing horrible games together. But, you know, he didn't throw a pick in 5 weeks. I mean, the guy is fine, you know. He's not Patrick Mahomes at this stage in his career, but he's not the guy that's out there losing us these games. If the defense was good enough, we could win this game. You know, if the offensive line wasn't complete trash, we could win with Ben. Maybe I've changed my tune on this a little bit. I think I was a little bit more on the Ben probably should have retired train earlier in the season and in the preseason. But
what do you think, Rich?
Well, that's what you always hear after he has a, you know, he doesn't play particularly well. But you know, nobody was saying that last week after the Chargers game. You know, so yeah, he isn't what he used to be. Absolutely. And you mentioned Gav about his mobility. That to me is what he's lost the most of. And that's what I've always heard. He's not an old man. He's 39. But I guess, you know, you add years to your body when you play professional sport. But I've always heard that. I remember from my grandfather, your legs, that's what goes first. You feel it in your legs. You know, they get weaker. You're not as agile. You're not as quick. And you can see it with Ben. The one time he got sacked, he tried to move up in the pocket, and he just looked so awkward, and he looked like an old man, literally like an old man. So that's an issue. But besides that, I think if you have a strong offensive line in front of him, I think he can still be effective. I think that is his biggest problem right now, dealing with that O-line. And he's never going to call them out. He just doesn't do that. But even that pick to Claypool, he had a guy right in his face. I don't know if it was Moore's guy. Somebody pushed him right back into his face when he threw that ball. So I think the offensive line, you know, has to take some responsibility for some of his poor play. But, you know, it's obvious he's not what he used to be. He never will be again. But, you know, I'm telling you guys, and I've said this before, I've been through those times. There's been a few of them since I've been a Steeler fan, since like 1969 that I can remember. When you have those times where you're trying to find your quarterback and you got this guy here, then this guy, then that guy, then finally you draft one if you're lucky enough, because some franchises doesn't seem like they ever do. But it's tough, man. It's a tough road. And I guarantee you, if Ben retires, there'll be points next season where people are going to be going, man, oh, I miss Ben. You know, it's just not that easy to do. It is not easy to replace a Hall of Famer when you're used to that level of play, even though he's over the hill now. He's you know, he's on the down part of his career, even though it's still tough to do.
Yeah. I mean, you look at how the Saints have done it, you know. I mean, that is a succession plan to be copied. I mean, you have Breeze, you have Winston, and you have, you know, your freakazoid QB weapon all in at the same time. What have the Steelers got? Nothing. Huh? I mean,
yeah,
it's scary. I mean, where? All right, let's say, all right, if you want to pull Ben, at what point? I mean, it's so hard. I mean, you can't just bench him, right? Because he's your franchise guy. It's his final year. You have to show him some respect, I think. I'm not sure they ever bench him this season. But no. At what point, if you were going to, you know, they lose three more games and they go, what's that, 5-8-1? Is that the point where you start thinking about, look, we have to, you know, maybe from halftime or whatever, we have to start bringing in Haskins, see what we got? I mean, what's the strategy here?
I don't think they do, because I don't think they feel that their quarterback for next season is on the roster right now. You know, so I don't know if it's even worth them to see what they have. I think Haskins will have a chance to compete in camp next year for sure. But I don't know if they turn to a Haskins or a Rudolph if that happens. I don't think so. I think it would have to be something where Ben has an injury that he feels like he could play with, but they feel like it's going to limit him too much. And maybe they pull him at that point. But I think if he's healthy, I don't think they pull him.
I really feel like he shouldn't have been on the field at the end of that game, though. By the fourth quarter, I was asking, what was he doing there? I mean, I don't know. Are we at the point where we don't value Ben enough to take him off the field when we get interrupted? I mean, strange to me. I mean,
well, they pulled Najee, right?
Yeah, yeah.
They pulled him out of the game pretty much. And they should have pulled Freiermuth out as well. Yeah. I mean, in hindsight, they should have, considering he's now in concussion protocol, but you know.
Well, my question is, if we're talking about the end of the game now, what the heck was up with that timeout usage?
Yeah.
That was weird. I mean, they let the clock run way down because you figure, okay, they know they can't win the game. They don't want to get anybody hurt. That's why they're not calling timeouts to try to get one more score. And then they call timeout with, like, I don't know, what, 14 seconds or something like that? I'm like, why? What was the purpose for that?
I just wondered if it was a procedural thing, like they weren't ready or they just wanted to ensure they were ready for what they were doing. I don't know. Yeah, it was weird.
Yeah.
It's the only explanation, I thought, because it can't have been a tactical one because you wouldn't let it run down beforehand.
Yeah, I don't know. I've seen Tomlin do some weird things with the clock.
Well, that's QB. I do think we would have seen more of Haskins. If there was any chance that Haskins was going to move, you know, compete next year, I think we would have seen a little bit of him by now. So I'm starting to think that that's definitely not going to happen. And I agree with Rich that the quarterback's probably not on the roster. Although the guy, this is the third time I brought up now. It's embarrassing. The guys in the Ravens podcast think that Aaron Rodgers is coming here. They're worried.
Do they? Are they on my team?
I mentioned you saying that, and they're concerned about that.
I put the cat up there, pigeons. Yeah. I mean, whatever. Great.
The Ravens, the cat loves the Ravens.
Sorry, that would be insane.
Even if that doesn't happen, I'm glad that I've made the Ravens UK podcast worry about that. That's great.
Let's talk about the bright spot. DJ continues to just be awesome, man. He's making some great plays out there. Shame he's on this offense, because I think if he was on a good offense, the national media would really be touting him as an all-pro kind of guy. I thought you were about to say something.
I was, yeah. Sorry. This is something that Lisa says. She hates my inhales because she knows that I'm going to say something. And now you're picking up on my inhales. She's like, because I inhale and then don't say anything. And then usually it's bad news. And then she's like, you inhaled. What are you going to say? And I'm like, nothing. I wasn't going to say anything. And she's like, yeah, you were. All right, yeah, you were a total bitch earlier. And then it like comes into a big row. So yeah, I need to like work on hiding my inhales.
I feel like the row there was not because of the inhalation, but probably because you call her a total bitch.
No, I know, but I try to I try and censor myself. Like, oh no, I shouldn't tell her that she was being a bitch. I should just not say anything. But I've already inhaled. Like, it's too late. Like, I can't. Like, it's like a subconscious.
But I think you could have inhaled, and then when she asked about the inhale, you could have been like, oh, you know, we didn't pick up the rice from Morrison's. You know, it didn't need to be the honesty bomb that you dropped.
Yeah, perhaps. There's other excuses than you're a bitch.
Whatever. You know what I mean. Okay. Maybe it was the rice thing, but then that would... You know. Anyway, what I was going to say is actually that was one of the really nice throws that Ben did make. Was, you know, he had pressure in his face from Moore's side yet again. I mean, changes are coming, Moore. I don't know. But yeah, that one-handed, the sideline grab for the 15-yarder. That, what a catch. Again, like he made one last week where he couldn't see the ball. Look, this one, I thought, oh, he's out. Oh, no, wait, he's caught it one-handed. Tony toe tap. Great. What a player. DJ. Amazing. What round was he drafted in? Fifth round?
DJ?
Something like that.
Was he?
Something. I think so.
Was it that late?
No, it was late and no one had him on their draft boards. He was like, and it was a reach or whatever, even at that stage. Like, who's this guy? And, I mean, if you're redrafting, where would you take him? Second round? Maybe even first round?
Third round pick. Pick 66.
Was he third round?
No, I guess I didn't think he was fifth round.
No, that's my mistake.
I thought he was second for a second.
Oh, maybe it was he had a fifth round grade on. Oh, okay. And he was taken in a third round, so it was a reach. I think that's maybe what it was.
Yeah.
But I think you take him higher than the third round now, do you think?
Oh, yeah. For sure.
The way DJ's playing right now, he's like a first round level wide receiver. He's insane. Like, if he was, imagine if he was playing with Dak Prescott or Patrick Mahomes right now, he'd be blowing the top off.
You know, there used to be a guy where I grew up who had a big old Humvee outside his house, a big yellow Hummer. You know, the big massive cars. It's like the size of a London flat. These big old cars, and he had a shit all of a house. And it feels like that at the moment with this offense. That DJ is the fancy car outside of the shit all of a house.
Yeah, it's you know, that happens a lot. So I live in a, it's not a bad place where I live, but it's, you know, it's fine. I see a guy outside. There's a guy that drives like a Lotus, like supercar, parked outside. And there's another guy with like a brand new Tesla, and I'm like, you're clearly spending too much of your income on your car if this is your car you're driving, but you live in the same flat as me. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
What are you doing?
A Lotus. What kind of Lotus?
I couldn't tell you the exact. Like,
don't see many Lotuses spring these days. That's kind of a rare car.
I'll try and take a picture of it next time I see it. But it's like a proper like sports car. And I'm just like, why?
Not
is
the the Vauxhall Carlton Lotus. What a motor! I was talking about that today, funny enough. That, what a car, right? So that car was actually the only car ever in the history of UK motoring that was requested and then banned by the police, because so it just looked like a normal car, right? It just looked like any other kind of 80s sedan, right? But it could do 180 miles per hour. It was like a supercar dressed up as like in plain disguise. So the police were like, no. You can't, this car cannot be road legal because every gangster in the country has got one of these cars. And, you know, they do a crime and then they're outrunning our police interceptors on the motorway. They're escaping. So they banned them. So there was only a limited production of these cars. And they now sell for like £100,000. Like if you can, you know, if you can find one. If I won the lottery, I'd go out get one of these cars because they're badass. Anyway, sorry, total distraction. Where were we?
Oh, sorry, we just got possessed by the spirit of Jeremy Clarkson there. And Top Gear.
He's not dead, is he?
Well, no, not yet.
Sorry.
What's the pity?
Sorry.
Oof! Wow, Jesus! Dave just wished death upon Jeremy Clarkson.
He's a farmer. Have you not seen his program?
Yeah, that's I don't like the guy.
Okay, he's quite right wing, but you know, fair enough. You don't like him.
That's about it for the receivers. We talked about Claypool already.
Johnson,
okay, so if DJ Claypool is that Lotus, Clarkson, what's Claypool? What does that make Claypool? Like a transit van at this point?
No, come on, man. No, come on.
Double-decker bus?
You know, you can do what you want about Claypool. He's still an awesome weapon. This offense is better with him than without him. What about, let's talk about Anthony Miller. Let's see a little bit more of him.
I just want to say, that catch, I mean, it went for 2 yards and it meant nothing, right? But what a catch.
Yeah.
The season. Huh?
Yeah.
It was. And I mean, talk about Claypool. He stopped playing because he thought it hit the deck. If Claypool had carried on and maybe got out in front of him and put a block, maybe that would have got back to the line, you know, got, it was short of the line of game. Maybe he'd have got there.
Well, Claypool does that a lot.
But you know, this is what happens. Ray Ray's out with COVID. I think Miller showed on that one play. Hey, maybe he's got something. Let's see.
Yeah.
I mean, I really liked him in the draft. I think he's been wasted in the Bears, and maybe they've got something there for cheap.
What happened to the other lad that we had at the start of the season? I forgot his name now.
Sims.
That's it. Where'd he go?
I don't know. He's a pretty fair receiver. I don't know why we haven't given him a shot either.
He disappeared. We seem to be rotating White through these practice squad guys. Sorry, Dave.
It was White as well, wasn't it? Did he disappear?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, when you've got DJ and Claypool, it's hard to... I mean, those two are just the Jekyll and Hyde, or, you know, little and large, cannon and ball. I mean, name your favourite double act. Why would you take one of them off? They're perfect. Thunder and lightning.
Name your favourite double act. Little and large, cannon and ball.
Chaz and Dave,
All such relevant references in 2021. This is turning into like an 80s nostalgia show with Gav.
Sorry.
You know, I'm not super high on Claypool. I want to see what he does next season, but he's not consistent. I like Juju better than Claypool,
he's
to be honest with you.
He's definitely stocked down this year, isn't he, Rich? I agree.
Yeah,
I agree.
He has. He came out like gangbusters last year, and he has not followed up with an improvement. I think he's declined, if anything.
Yeah.
That's a second year slump.
Yeah,
could be.
You mentioned Juju. I'm thinking that maybe we try to push to keep him around a bit more, considering the Claypool maybe lack of progression. I think maybe he's someone who hangs around longer. I don't know.
I agree. I would like to see that.
I think funnily enough, Ray Ray was a loss. I think he's actually brought something to, you know, the sweeps and the run after catch and the finding little space and doing some zigga-zigga kind of little roots.
He's played well.
Zigga-zigga.
Is that the technical term?
It is now.
He's definitely played well. I like Juju in the slot better because of his physicality, but I thought Ray Ray's played well, and I like him in the return game too.
Yeah.
McFadden looked kind of nice in the return game in this game.
Has he put on weight? Has he looked bigger? Dave, you're the McFarlane expert. Has he put a bit of weight on?
I haven't weighed him recently. He's not been around my gap.
But he looked wider to me. He looked a little bit more jacked.
Maybe.
Man body.
Is that going to give him like a lower center of gravity so he doesn't fall over three yards behind the line of scrimmage?
I think he's not helped by the fact that he's got sort of been a very erratic running style. He seems to like sway a lot. He sort of moves back and forth as he's running. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like his shoulders move a lot as he's running. Maybe that means that he's not got the same, like I say, the same center of gravity as other backs.
I thought I got excited in the fourth quarter. He looked like he was going to break one, but no, got caught 3 yards. But hey, 3 yards past the line of scrimmage, Dave. We were talking about, will he ever get past the line of scrimmage, where he did in this game?
Baby steps.
Yeah.
No run game to speak of at all in this one. Najee's now at 2.9 yards. We're going down average.
Yeah, he didn't really find his rhythm in the passing game either, did he?
No, not really. Not particularly involved. Only 8 rushing attempts. I mean, that's game script, I suppose, but I don't know. It's the run game, I feel like there's nothing to say. We've said it all, and it continues to be this way. If we're going to keep getting blown out in the first quarter of games, we're not going to see a lot of Najee on the ground, are we?
And Canada's having to like pull out every stop to get 2 yards. You know, they're like doing, you know, their best blocking scheme, tackle over motions, and you know it goes for 3 yards. You know, whereas the Bengals are just going into whatever, you know, combo block, get 9 yards. I mean, so depressing, man. Why? There was the problem last year. It's not been fixed. If anything, it's got worse.
So offensive line. So let's just recap. What do we need in the draft? We need a QB. Potentially like a third wide receiver would be nice if we don't keep Juju. We don't need a tight end. That's good. Although maybe we could do with like a backup. We don't need running back. That's nice. Offensive line. We need all of them. Just any position. Defensive line. We'll take anything. Outside linebacker would be nice to have some depth there. Middle linebacker. Yep. Cornerback. Definitely. Safety, probably not. Keep Edmonds, probably some depth. So,
I think you go for me, it's like blue chip O line, road grading, physical, like nasty MFR, horrible man. You know, find the most horrible man in the draft and take him and put him on the O line.
The more convictions, the better.
Yeah, and then, inside linebacker and cornerback are the next two. Two ones, probably cornerback first, because they to get those pure skills, you need to go higher, and then linebacker in the third round. That's probably where I'd be looking.
You know, we need the first guy, whoever the first guy is in this draft, who's like that country guy who rips open like logs of wood with his bare hands, and he's like, what's that guy the Ravens drafted called? His name's like Ben Powers or something. We need that guy.
Ben Cleveland.
That's it. But like you know.
It was Quinn Miners, wasn't it, in the last draft? Yeah. Last third draft.
Get one of them.
Or Tevin Jenkins, if it wasn't for his poorly back. Some asshole. That's what you need.
Yeah.
That's what this team needs. I mean, they're really missing Dotson. You know, it's like Finney. I mean, it just Finney brings zero wallop in the run game. Nothing. I mean, the guys are, you know, fine. But, you know, he gets driven back in pass protection, but just nothing. No ass whoop. And then Green. I mean, Rich, do you want to do your weekly Green rant? Go ahead.
No, guys, I watched this game once when it was live, and I didn't even bother to watch it again. I couldn't sit through it again. I saw some things he was doing during the game, but, you know, it's basically, you know, copy and paste what I've said earlier you know, in the earlier games, and it applies. He's just not good. I was watching a game. Somebody brought in their backup center, and I'm like, ooh, I wonder how he compares to Green. And I watched him in pass protection. He took three steps back and bam, anchored, and like that was it. Stopped the guy dead in his tracks. I'm like, this is the backup center. I'm like, there are probably backup centers in the league that are better than that guy. So yeah, I'm just, you know, whatever I said before, just that applies.
Yeah. I mean, there was one play. He did he won the rep, right? He won it. It was like third or fourth quarter. And then at the end of the rep, he just got tossed to the ground like Santa throwing his sack of presents, you know, in disgust. It was just, oh, come on, man. You can't even finish a rep without ending up on the floor. I don't know. What do you do?
Disgusted Santa. I like that analogy. Disgusted Santa.
So then I heard somebody saying, okay, so what would you guys rather have? Like, would you have rather that you did draft Freiermuth or that you took Creed Humphrey in that spot?
Mm, yeah.
And it makes you think, and I still have to go with Freiermuth because I think those guys are tough to find that could have the receiving tight end isn't super tough to find these days. There's a lot of athletic tight ends, but that one that has the possibility to become a good blocker as well is tougher to find. So I still like the Freiermuth pick, but it makes you think, like, you know, Creed Humphrey's doing pretty well.
Yeah, I mean, down to down, he probably has more impact that you don't notice, whereas Muth's going to have more highlight plays.
Right.
It's that old thing. But he is quite special, Freiermuth. You got the way he finds the soft zones is a real talent. And we've seen that those difficult, you know, touchdown catches he's making, that's money right there. So, yeah, I don't know. It's up more upside with Muth.
Yeah, that catch he made last week was fantastic.
Mm.
Oh, man, that was a great catch. I didn't think there's any way he's going to make that grab. It was really nice. He is just phenomenal hands.
Was that the play, the touchdown, was that the play that he got concussed on? The miracle end zone?
I don't know. I'm not sure if that was the play.
Because was it worth it? If that's the case. Do you trade one touchdown at the end in garbage time?
Well, is he? Did you guys hear? Is he still in concussion protocol? Do they think he's going to play?
As things stand right now, as far as I'm aware, that he's still in protocol.
And I think he'll be out by the sounds of it.
Yeah.
Now, sorry. I saw an interesting thought experiment from Tommy Jaggy, Gav, a guy you've had some dealings with. He said this season, Pat Freiermuth has been one of the top five players on this team. Is he a top five stealer in this team? That second round pick, rookie.
I think you have to. Sure. Yeah, definitely. I think you have to say
for
that.
Sure.
Who else would you put ahead of him?
That's it, right? So Cam, TJ, maybe Minka for his body of work.
Naji.
I don't think I'd put Naji above him at this point.
For sheer volume. I mean,
without Naji above Pat Freiermuth?
Yeah.
Okay.
He touches the ball way, way more.
Yeah, but this is not just... Like, all right, I mean, Kendrick Green touches the ball in every play, but, like, Pat Freiermuth is just...
He's a skill player. He brings a lot more to the table than Green does, for sure.
I think you've soured just because this performance wasn't... Was
I'm not soured on Naji at all. This is not me saying...
No, but you've gotten the things that he does.
I have not. I just think Pat Freiermuth is showing to be, so far at least, that he could become an elite tight end.
Naji is bringing what I was talking about with the highlight play versus down to down. Naji's bringing both. He's bringing the down to down and the highlight play.
So, well, look at it this. I'm sorry, go again.
No, go on.
I was going to say, look at it this way. For what their responsibilities are on the field, Naji is better. Freiermuth needs to be a good pass receiver and he needs to be a good blocker. He's not a good blocker right now. Naji needs to be a good runner, a good receiver, and a good blocker in the pass blocking. And he's good at all three of those.
Yeah. I agree.
Okay.
So I just want to talk about, like, more. So, and maybe this will, I mean, maybe we're done here, but maybe this will lead into a little bit of Ravens chat. But
I mean, Moore is consistently now getting beat around the edge, getting driven back, causing problems. Bano is there. Two snaps, I think, tackle eligible. He's a big boy. This you know, Banner is probably the biggest O lineman they have. I mean, he's untested. They need to find out what they've got. Is it time to consider benching more, moving Chucks across, and putting Banner at right tackle? What do you think? Is that the call?
Oh, I would try it. Because, yes, Moore's a rookie, and you absolutely want to see what you have in him. But Banner doesn't have a lot of offensive snaps in his career either. Hmm. When you think about it, like everybody was saying last year, okay, well, we have Banner. You know, we're okay at right tackle. Well, actually, no. Compared to the rest of the guys, yeah. But it's crazy that was like one of our more experienced guys with Trey Turner. But he really isn't that experienced. So we still don't know really what we have with him. I would at least play him into the game. I mean, for sure. I mean, because, you know, I don't know if you want to play each of them a half or something like that. But I would get him more reps. Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of weird that they've kind of got a decent three tackles and no guard depth, and they've lost all their guards. It's kind of unfortunate that they haven't lost one of their tackles to kind of even out the thing. What was Tomlin brought out an old quote? What was it? When you've got red paint, you paint the barn red.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite ones of his.
Yeah, it's a good one. Yeah. So, in that respect, is it time to paint the barn red and put Banner out there, Dave? What do you think?
I'm sort of siding with Rich on this, that he's not got the experience. So going into the season, like you say, everyone was saying that, oh, we're okay. But there's a reason why they've not put him in straight away. Maybe that's him recovering from his injury still, and maybe that's that they're feeling happy with what they've got elsewhere at that position. You know, I don't know if they've got as much faith in him as we do as a fan group, you know.
Yeah, I just think, you know, the changes have got to be run. You've got to make changes after that loss. You can't just turn up with the same starting 11 and expect different results.
Is it on the O line though? Is it that position?
Yeah, on offense, I think so. Yeah, they couldn't get the run game going. They couldn't protect Ben. Need to get more physical up front. You've got two rookies out there, Green, who's getting killed, Moore, who's getting killed. Who, you know, I mean, if they had better guard depth, you could slide. You know, you had Hasenauer, you could put him in, or Finney, you could put him in at centre. But I don't think you can do that because you haven't got the guard depth. But you have got the tackle depth. You've got, you know, Hague's on COVID or whatever, but you've got three decent tackles. If one of them goes down, you can put the other one in. So let's change it up a little bit. Let's try and get a little bit more push in the run game. Is what I think. That's what I'm hoping they do.
I would like to see. He's got so little tread in a Steelers uniform. I'd like to see what he can do at least, just so we know where we are next season. I don't want another year of just this shadow of Zach Banner hanging over us, not quite sure whether he's going to be anything.
Yeah, I mean, the consistency was the thing, right? That's what we were talking about. You didn't want to break up the unit. Well, the unit's broken. Like it's not worked. Like it's done. So let's shift it up. Let's bring in a new guy that's wanting to impress and has some desire and isn't worrying about his past failure.
Yeah, what's the worst thing that could happen? Speaking of offensive line, sorry, this is a non sequitur, but I just realized, you know, when I was talking about Ben Powers, Ravens have a Ben Powers and a Ben Cleveland.
I'm pretty sure it was Cleveland that released the Rocky four star. Yeah.
That's where I'm getting confused. They have both. So Ben Powers is a person. He does exist. He's the left guard. But he just isn't the man I thought he was.
He's not the man.
No. That just caught me. As I rolled down my notes, I just saw the Ravens depth chart. I was like, oh, he does exist. I'm not going nuts.
Okay. So, anyone else worth mentioning, or is that it? Have we covered everyone? Special teams? We didn't really cover special teams, but do we need to?
I don't think the great deal happened, did it? Balls hit his one kick. The punting wasn't great, and then Ray Ray was out, so McFarlane looked kind of nice, but I mentioned that. Not a great deal else to say.
Okay.
Okay, let's talk about how we're going to get thrashed by the Ravens this week.
Oh, thank God, we're off that game.
Now, we always pick to... it feels like a cliche now. We always pick to split with the Ravens every year, right? Now, is that still going to happen this year, or are we just going to get blasted twice?
I don't know, it's difficult because we play the Ravens at the end of the year, so anything could happen.
That's true.
I mean, it could be a... it was RG3 last time, but it could be a Tyler Huntley versus, who knows, Dwayne Haskins. James Morgan? Is it James Morgan? Could be James Morgan. In, you know, who knows? So I'm not going to make
who
any
is
predictions.
James Morgan?
Is it James Morgan?
I don't know who that is.
They signed a QB to the practice squad.
Oh, the Steelers did. Okay, sorry. I thought you were talking about the Ravens.
No. Yeah. It's, where is he? Michigan State? Something like that.
Oh, that guy's seeing no game time. They're gonna keep rolling Mason Rudolph out there repeatedly, hoping something different to happen. That's what they're gonna do.
Sure. Yeah. So where do we normally go here? Do we normally go picks first, survivor game, or do we talk about the opponent next?
We usually talk about the opponent, but I don't see how what changes in this game. They did thank us for sending them Villanueva though.
Do you want to talk about? You mentioned it three times. Let's talk about it properly. So I hear you made a guest appearance by invite onto the Ravens UK podcast. How was that, Simon?
Where did you hear that? That's strange that you would bring that up.
They can't have heard this show, right? Or they wouldn't have been invited.
Well, no, certainly not. I think what originally happened was they put out a clip of their show on Twitter, and I happened across it and thought, hey, this seems kind of simpatico with what we do, with our style. I can't remember what it was about, but it was similarly nonsensical. So I thought, well, you're like the mirror version of us, but then we found out they're far more professional than we are. But nice group of guys for Ravens fans. We'll probably get one of those guys on for the second matchup to talk a bit deeper about their team. But yeah, just jumped on for 25 minutes, talked about the Steelers a little bit and my thoughts. And
what was their pressing question? So they asked you about Ben, obviously.
Yeah, we
mentioned that before.
Talked a bit about Ben. Talked a bit about Devin Bush and his struggles. And we were talking about him in comparison to Patrick Queen because I wanted to know a bit about him because we've spoke about him on this show, right? Because you know we quite liked him coming out and then. He's been a bit of a topic of conversation over there, similar to the way Bush has been here. Just talk about who scares me on the Ravens side of things. I think in this game, Hollywood Brown does, especially if Hayden's not out there. Although I think Hayden's going to be back for this game, right?
Yeah.
So hopefully we can quiet him down. But no, it was nice to just get on there and you know. Also, it's nice to do a podcast and not be responsible for the format of it. You know, that's new to me. That's always nice. I don't have to drive the conversation. I'm answering questions instead of asking them.
Oh, what? You're putting yourself up on a pedestal there. About how easy our job is compared to yours. Is that it?
No, it's just different. It's just different. You know, I'm not worrying about the... what's the word I'm looking for? The...
the runtime. The
schedule. Yeah, I'm not looking at the clock and thinking, God, we've been talking about this shitty game for an hour and a half.
Well, if you don't want to be here, you know.
Yeah, I'm going to join the Ravens podcast, Dave. Full time.
How sore were they about the pathetic win over the Browns on Sunday Night Football?
I don't think we talked about it, to be honest. I think they were talking about that because I only joined for 25 minutes. I didn't join for the full show. It was just to talk about the Steelers a little bit. So
they glossed over that, did they? They completely ignored the four interceptions, did they?
yeah, we didn't get into that. Something tells me Lamar Jackson's not going to throw four interceptions against the Steelers defense.
Possible.
Will he throw four incompletions against the Steelers defense? Is maybe the better question.
Yeah. Sad stats is that the Ravens have a 10% chance of winning the Super Bowl and a 56% chance of making the AFC Championship game. Do you want to guess what the Steelers' chance of winning the Super Bowl? That must be playing in the Super Bowl versus chance of playing in the AFC Championship game. Do you want to guess the percentages of that?
I'll say 2% and 1%.
I stopped the game right there. You cracked it. Yeah, that's yes! Absolutely right. Yeah, 1% of playing the Super Bowl, 2% of making the AFC Championship. 2%. of making the AFC champs again. That's sad. Just for clarity's sake, Bengals 4% playing the Super Bowl, 19% chance of playing in the championship game. Browns only slightly better than the Steelers, 1% chance Super Bowl, 3% championship game. So it looks pretty bad for people that pick the Browns in the preseason.
All right. Well, the Ravens have done what they always do. They've found ways to win games they should have lost all season, and now here they are. Are they top of the AFC North now? Where are they?
Yeah.
The AFC, I mean.
Top of the AFC, yeah. Joined with the Patriots. I mean, what a depressing...
Oh, no.
2-8-3 teams. Yeah.
We truly are in the darkest time. I have no doubts that this... In fact, go put money on it. Go put your house on it. We're going to have a Bucks-Patriots Super Bowl, and I'm going to be forced to sit there and swallow it whole.
Are we on the Thanos timeline? Is that what you're saying? We're on the darkest timeline. This is all Farage crashing on his plane when he should have died, and we're on the one where he got out, right? And then everything's gone bad ever since that point.
The only thing that can save us from a Tom Brady versus Bill Belichick Super Bowl is that asteroid that's going to hit us in 11 days or whatever it is. It's the only thing. The only thing left to hope for.
It's got a smiling Henry Ruggs face on it.
Jesus Christ.
Can the moon wobble a little bit more, a little bit faster to bring the end a bit quicker?
Oh, God.
Or is that not how it works?
Things have become quite dire. We've called for the death of Jeremy Clarkson. We've wished that a plane crash had been more fatal. We've suggested that an asteroid hit the Earth to stop Tom Brady's dominance. Oh, dear. Oh.
I do think we need to talk about the Ravens versus the Browns game. I think that was... quite instructional, don't you think, about these two, our two rivals? I mean, this was Sunday Night Football, a chance for someone. I was expecting the Ravens to beat down on the Browns, personally, because I'm out on the Browns. They couldn't do it. Neither team looked pretty good.
Well, that's the question. Is this Ravens team good? I don't even know.
Well, to be fair, Jackson just come back off COVID, right? So he's not 100% himself, a bit like how TJ was. He's not quite there. I think a big part of COVID is the mental aspect of it, right? It knocks you about, doesn't it? I mean, even if you're an athlete, I can imagine that it has a considerable effect on your body and your mind, that it's, you're not quite in that same headspace. So I think it's I think that's what's affecting him for this game, particularly when it comes to the interceptions and reading of the game. But it's going to be, I think it's going to be the bounce back for him. I think it's, if you're going to find your feet against anyone, it's going to be against this Steelers defense right now.
This is not the Ravens run game that we've become accustomed to since Lamar's been there, right? I mean, this is, you've got this comedy caravan of veteran backs. I mean, a clear downgrade from Dobbins, Ingram, Edwards, you know. They eat the clock on you. That's one thing they do. You know, they run up the time. But, Freeman's the 32nd ranked back on PFF. RJ's the 34th, by the way. But, you know, let's not talk about that. And Murray's the 52nd. So it's not like these guys are really any presence at all. Obviously, Lamar... But he seems to be trying to air it a bit more. He does seem a little bit more accurate on those sort of intermediate throws than he was before. But the picks that he's coming off, that's got to be in his head. It just feels like the offense, the Ravens' offense, can be knocked off course. If you killed a run, they don't have an answer. They're in the hole. But can the Steelers do that? I mean, the thing about them is that I'll come back to that. But the thing about the Ravens' offense is they're the second in the league in total plays run behind Tennessee, which is a result of the start of the running game. You know, so you have to keep up. You know, the offense is averaging half a yard per play more than the Steelers. That adds up a hell of a lot. But the one thing is that the one advantage the Steelers have is the Ravens are 25th in the league in third down percentage. The Steelers are 8th in the league, if you believe that. So this really weird stat. It's the only advantage the Steelers have over them. And perhaps it's because their run game gets them over the line before they need to get onto third down. And if they're not, if they're on third down, they're throwing, and that's where their offense fails.
I wouldn't have put the Steelers eighth and third down. That's strange. That's weird. It must be run after catch. You know, I don't know. It's weird. But that's the only thing that we've got going for us. So, you know, the run game, the run defense, Steelers are losing this game, I think.
Yeah, it's tough. This is the clearest I've been in a long time. I mean, I picked the Steelers to lose probably more than anyone on the show because I'm naturally cynical, but I don't see the route to victory here at all. But then, you know, these things happen, don't they? You say that, and then this will be the game where we show up, and then, you know, everything's topsy turvy with the Ravens, and you know, I think if anyone's due a loss that you don't see coming, it probably is the Ravens. So, you know, it's going to be a strange one, but I don't know. I don't know what the answer is going to be for Mark Andrews. That worries me. And then not being able to stop the run is just going to be an issue with every single team we face, isn't it? But Lamar, I mean, look what Justin Herbert did to us, and then imagine Lamar Jackson's there instead. It's gravely, gravely concerning.
Yeah. One more point, and then I'll hand over the mic to someone else. But I mean, their defense is built, predicated on aggressive blitzing. That's what they do. This O-line against that aggressive blitz, I mean, can you know, how quickly can Ben get it out? Can he get it out in under 2 seconds? I mean, is that what we're looking at here? Because their defense can actually be exposed when they try and sit back. That's when they get picked apart, and they're actually second last in the league in pass yards allowed, compared to, you know, Steelers are 10th in the league in pass yards allowed. So, you know, you can pass on them if you can throw into the blitz. So there is that is the way to beat this team, right? Ben needs to pick them apart with his arm, move away from the run. It's just, can he do that? That's the question. And without Muth.
That's just it. That if this Ravens defense can do anything, it's stopping the run. When you look at this last game against the Browns, they held the Browns to 40 rushing yards. 40. And if you want to beat the Steelers right now, you stop the run and you make Ben beat you. And if you're making Ben throw it 30, 40 times, at some point you're going to have turnovers, you're going to have mistakes. And that's the game plan for anyone coming up against us right now, is make Ben beat us, because we don't want Najee to beat us, because he will. If you give him enough of a chance and let up on him, he's going to beat you. You got to make Ben beat you. So I have to believe that's what they're going to do for this, you know?
You're absolutely right, Dave. Najee is not beating this team. Ravens defense, second best in not allowing rushing yards, first in stopping red zone touchdowns on the ground, first in stopping third downs, and third in stopping first downs. Like, this is a stiff test. Rich, you got some, what would you do?
I don't know. I don't know. I think Harbaugh's a better coach than Tomlin. I could, you know, what you were saying earlier, Gav, I could see they will blitz the Steelers. And I could see, you know, Harbaugh in the meeting saying, yeah, we're going to blitz them. They know we're going to blitz them. And this is how they're going to respond to that blitz. And this is how we're going to beat their response. Because probably what they're going to do is they're going to throw a bunch of short passes and screen passes to catch, you know, to catch the blitz and, you know, open those things up. And I think the Ravens will be ready for it. You know, I just don't see how the Steelers can win this game. Of course they can. We said it many times this season. They have the capability to beat anyone and lose to anyone. They've shown that. But I don't think they do it this week. I don't think it's going to happen. You know, Freiermuth is a huge security blanket for Ben, and him not playing and Juju not playing, that's not good. I don't know. I don't have much more to say. I just don't see us winning.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, the only thing is their back end is not great. So that's the only weakness they have. Because even when it comes down to, if it's a tight game, they've got Tucker. That's an advantage.
Yeah. Well, that's what I would like to see, a field goal battle. You know, Tucker and Boswell just battling it out. You know, they Tucker kicks a 58-yarder, Boz kicks a 60, Tucker kicks a 63, and you know, it'd be that would be a little fun.
Getting Tucker's head, the game that destroys Tucker. It goes on a 10-game missed Pat run because of Boswell. Yeah, that'd be great. Let's do that. Right. Let's kill Tucker. That's what we're hoping for, a kick fest.
Yeah. It's never going to be
is
the Ravens, is it?
Is Calais Campbell back? Calais, whatever.
Calais.
Is he back? Calais. His name's Calais. I'm sorry. You're saying it Calais. It's wrong. It's Calais, right? We're closer to the place.
He's not French.
Yeah, but it's named after a weird port where lots of people seeking passage to the UK.
You don't know what he's named after. He could be named after anything. I don't know. I'm sure there's something called Calais.
Calais, it's missing a U. All right, okay. Calais Campbell, highest graded defender on their team, is out with concussion versus the Browns. Is he back? Do we know?
I don't know.
I couldn't. Mm. Scary front. I mean, they've got Tyce Bowser and Houston. They're both 80-plus pass rushing grade, PFF. They've got Adafi Awe, great rookie season.
Oh, he's looking good.
Yeah, I mean, he's in the conversation for D-Roy, right? I mean,
yeah.
I think Parsons probably going to get it, but... I mean, wow, a nice rangy, bendy edge guy they got there. Another classic Raven. I mean, where'd they just seem to find these guys? And some dude called Joe Thomas, not the tackle, he's an edge rusher. He's playing well. It's their fourth guy coming off the bench. Situational pass rusher. He's playing well, so.
Yeah, so, they draft really well.
Yeah.
They really draft well.
Frustrating. So, yeah. Do you want to pick the game? Should you pick the scores?
If we have to, Gav. If we have to, we'll do it.
Who wants to go first? Shall I go first?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. I'll recap what we did last week. So, Rich, you've done quite well against... yeah. All right. So, you picked the Chargers, Rich, to beat Denver. That was a win. Si, you picked Detroit. That was a loss.
Almost.
Dave, you picked the Panthers. That was a loss. And I picked Dallas, and that was a loss. Jeez. So that was a point there for you, Rich. We all failed on the score despite our patchwork efforts. Dave, you picked a Muth TD. Now, it came in the fourth quarter, but I still think that was...
That was the first big play, man.
Yeah. In garbage time. I mean, it feels like a kind of pathetic victory, but you won that one. I'll give you that. And Rich, you picked that too, so well done. None of us got a defensive score, so that left me with
zero
and Si with
zero.
Right, Rich, you got two, so you've taken the lead. And Dave,
don't we get a point for picking the game as well?
Well, none of us got near with the score, really.
Oh, I didn't know. I thought we get a point for picking the winner, though.
Win or loss? No. It's got to be. It's
got really?
No. Oh, it's really tough. I mean, we can discuss. Oh, wow. I'm sorry.
Not your fault. I did not realize that because, you know, when you take a chance and pick an upset, you don't even get a point, even if... Wow, okay.
Possibly. We can discuss this going ahead. For clarity, what the rules are is you get 2 points for exact score. And
okay.
You get 1 point for correct spread. Like correct differential, but within of a field goal.
Okay.
Yeah.
I thought there was an opportunity for more points. I thought we got a point for picking which team wins. So we don't even have to pick necessarily which team wins. It's just which team wins in the scores.
No. It has to be correct winner as well. It's quite tough, this. Maybe this is quite stringent, this, the scoring game. I think perhaps next year we have a look at maybe relaxing the rules a little bit. But hey, you shouldn't be complaining. You're 2 points out in front right now.
No,
so,
I'm not complaining. I was just surprised. Yeah, I didn't realize.
It's tough. We're, you know, still fine tuning this game.
3 years in.
Yeah. Right. So anyway, I'm picking a loss. I'll go first. I'm going for a low scorer. I'm going 17 Ravens, 13 Steelers.
They already asked me for a score, so I'll stick with the same one. 27-17 Ravens.
27-17?
Yeah.
10-point game. Okay.
Maybe generous.
You see, I think next year we should do something with the spread. Like, we have to pick against the spread. I think that
perhaps be a little bit fairer than what we do here. But anyway, who wants to go next?
I'll go, Dave.
No, I'm just wondering how Gav is justifying a low scorer, considering the defensive output we just saw.
I think we just discussed. I think that the struggles that the Ravens have had in the last game will continue. Okay. I think perhaps they will get a little bit of pressure. They'll try and disrupt the run game. I think changes are coming, and I think the Ravens team not as you know you get to 8-3 this season's been a little bit surprising. I'm still picking them to win, but I just think we'll disrupt and get them off balance a little bit. Division game, anything's possible.
Okay. Go ahead, Rich, with your scores.
Okay. I have the Ravens 34-24.
10-point game as well. Dave?
I was tempted to go for another blowout, but I'm going for a 28-13. I have to have some faith or I'm going to go insane.
28-13 to the Ravens?
Yes, a loss.
So that's a sweep for the Ravens. Okay. I've gone for a DJ touchdown. First defensive play. Big play.
I'll go Najee Rush this week. Why not?
Why not indeed?
There's no moves. I'll
go Steelers don't have an O-line. But...
I'll go Najee reception.
Najee receiving touchdown.
I also had a DJ touchdown. But should I change it? Rather than should I be boring and go with the same?
No. Do what you think.
No. Go with what you feel. Right, I'm putting that in. I've done the same as last week. I've gone for a Highsmith sack. Si, you seem to be going next.
I'm going Cam sack this week. There's nobody else left. Cam sack.
Rich?
What is? Have we heard what Hayden's chances of playing are? Did anybody hear?
I think he's playing.
Yeah? Okay, I'm going to go Hayden interception.
Okay. We're all going for the same picks we did 3 weeks ago. Bizarre coincidence. There's a very bizarre coincidence happened in my life right now. It's starting to question. In fact, there's been a few in the last couple of weeks that's made me think perhaps I am actually player one in some giant video game. Yeah, but we'll get onto that in later.
I don't know that you're necessarily player one, but we're definitely in the matrix. We're in the matrix. Yeah.
I'm in the party that's playing. Okay, Dave.
But I'll mix things up a little bit. I'll go for the Pierre redemption game. I'm gonna go for the James Pierre pick,
which you did 2 weeks ago. Okay,
not three weeks ago.
That was the TJ strip sack. But you know, okay, that's good. I'd like to see the redemption. All right,
survivors.
I'm going to go last in this one because I've already made my pick. So it's there in black and white. So we'll go reverse order, Dave.
I am taking the Bengals against the Chargers.
Whoa, bold.
Being fruity.
Okay, just check it. Yep, that's fine. That's a legal pick. You've not picked them before. Cincinnati against LAC. And Rich?
I'll take the Colts to beat the Texans.
See, I thought about that one. I thought, division game, tricky.
Yeah, they are tricky, but I feel good about the Colts.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm also going to take the Colts if I haven't taken it before. I don't think I have.
No, you have not. Okay. I'll give you that. I've gone with the Vikings against Detroit.
Yeah, that was my other option.
I'm kind of sneaky on the Vikings. I think they're a good team. I think they're...
I saw an article this week though, where someone, because I feel like the Vikings have like the pendulum swung the wrong direction now. Because I saw an article that someone was saying like, "Oh, are the Vikings the best team in the NFC?" And I was like, "Calm down, let's not get carried away."
Well, yeah, I mean, we've got to see how they get over the Madison. I mean, the Cook injury. What are you gonna say, Rich?
What's the total score?
Overall so far?
Yeah, our standings.
Right, so Si and Dave are on 10. I'm on 12 and you're on 14.
We've fallen behind, Dave. To be expected.
Wait a second.
Oh, Rich is tabulating his own scores.
Yeah, no, this is wrong, Gav. The Broncos beat the Chargers. I didn't win that last week. You said the Chargers. I picked the Chargers.
Oh.
And they won.
Oh, wait. Whoa. Did they lose? Oh, they did.
Lost. Yeah, they lost their Broncos.
Oh, dear. Oh, no.
So Rich is saying that he's got 1 point less. That's not where I thought one this point was less. Going. I think we should give him that point for his honesty.
I'm honest. I'm not going to. I don't want to cheat at anything.
Wow. Why did I have that wrong? That's interesting.
I wasn't sure because I didn't really pay attention, but I just looked on all the scores now.
You're right. That's strange. I lost money on the Chargers as well, so I should remember that. So well picked up. So you're on 13 points and I'm on 12.
Okay.
This is why I shouldn't be in charge of these things, because I have no time to double check. I've shared this to you, right? So you can check it yourself. Feel free.
Bold of you to expect us to do that, though. Oh, dear. Okay. Kebab ball?
Yeah. Let's do that.
Yeah, unbelievable. It's like, it's all over. I want to get my head chopped off. Where's the guillotine?
Juju Connor. Do we know his name? This is getting embarrassing.
Oh, I didn't look it up this week. I did not check. I was relying on you this week. I forgot to check it.
Don't rely on me for anything. Oh. Sorry, Juju Connor. You're gone.
You're gone.
Down to the final four now, but there has been a snafu.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about this. There's been some waiver wire drama with Phil, of all people.
This is awkward, yeah. Feels like a little bit of a conspiracy, but it wasn't. So we've all put in our waiver claim. For some reason, Phil's waiver claims didn't go through. What do you think I should do here? I mean,
I really don't know. Apparently, he had some issues with the app, though. It wasn't like you didn't do anything.
No, it wasn't my fault. He put his waivers in. They didn't register with the app. And then his team went blank. And then his team came back. And the other... I mean, we're down to four. Excuse me. We're down to four now. And so the other three, me, Dave, and Mike, all got a proud shame from the podcast, by the way. We all got our waivers. And Phil didn't get any. So... I don't know, it's tricky. Partly through can I go through and manually undo that and then rerun waivers? I mean, I was kind of trying to get Phil to contact Sleeper and get them to do it themselves. I don't know. What should I do here? This is tricky. I don't want him to feel like hard done by, though.
I know, it's tough. I don't know. I don't know what you can possibly do to make it fair. Yeah, you didn't. You didn't cause the issue, so I don't know.
No, but it's not fair because three of us have got mega players, mega teams, and he hasn't.
I mean, you could roll back waivers, but then everyone's going to know who everybody wants. That is tough.
Yeah. What you say?
Can you do it? Can you start that from scratch and redo it?
I could. Yeah, I could. I could drop. I mean, I've got the thing here, so I could go through and drop every player that's been claimed, but then. I mean, my main issue is it's going to take me about an hour. I said to Phil, like, please just get in contact with Sleeper. They should have the record of your waiver claims. It didn't go through for whatever reason. I don't know. But I mean, that aside, the teams now are ridiculous. I mean, me versus Mike this week, Rogers versus Jackson. I mean, he's got Kamara. I've got, you know, Jefferson, Patterson, Johnson. I mean, every single position on the squad, he's got Kelsey, I've got Kittle, you know, it's like our backups, Brady and Prescott. I mean, it's like every single player is a first round or second round pick. It's getting ridiculous. It's just a lottery now at this point. So, but it's interesting. But yeah, this has happened before. This happened with, I think, a couple of weeks ago, didn't it, with the snafu over the waivers when someone messed it up. Now, this seems to be an app issue, but
I was going to say, I would have him, you know, find out what happens. Have him contact, you know, Sleeper first and see if they can do anything. And if not, I would do it over. I would start it over. Because if it's nothing that he did wrong and the app just screwed him, then that's just not fair. And then he's going to, you know, he's going to be pretty bitter about the whole thing. And well, he should, because it's not his fault.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's where I'm at. I'm kind of trying to press him to contact Sleeper because I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it.
It's so much work.
I don't want to do it. No, I feel your pain. I feel your pain. It's tough. We've only got 2 days.
Yeah, I know. I mean, we could get into a situation where waivers don't run in time, and then no. But maybe that's fair. We just go in with the teams that we had.
Well, is he pretty much guaranteed a loss if this isn't fixed?
Dave, you're up against him. And actually, no, he's not. The projected score totals are 269 versus 264 right now. So he's got a 47% chance of winning. So I don't know.
Yeah, I think you got to fix it though.
Yeah. I don't know. I'll get onto it after the show. I'll message him. I've messaged him before. He's not been proactive. Maybe he doesn't care. He's too busy sorting through his memorabilia and trading cards.
Buying Alabama shirts and trying to get Jalen Waddle's home
planning farm. Planning his move for next year. Yeah. Anyway, enough chat about that. Are we ready for going to our special place?
Yeah.
Four large dollars, kid.
Everything on them?
Do you want onions on your set?
I do. Plenty of onions.
Now, if you've made this to this point in the show and you're still depressed, well done to you, because we've not exactly helped you with your depression after that Steelers loss. So I thought I'd cheer you all up with a bit of a game.
Oh, a game.
So you're all welcome to...
Oh, wait, if we're going to do a game, I need another Wii. Oh, damn.
I'll tell you what, I'll try and stall.
Is there some record keeping needed? Do I need to do some spreadsheet wizardry here?
Sorry, go on Wii quick. You'll need to keep score. Okay. So, should I hold up going over the rules?
Hold up going over the rules. So wait, I'll fire up a new spreadsheet. Hang on. What do I need to do? Is it, what are we doing? Is it points, win prizes, or is it survivor, or what is it?
It's points based. It is points based. So it's basically based around slang. So I've basically gone through all you three guys' regions and taken some slang. So the emphasis is not on you getting other people's slang correct, guessing their slang correctly. It's getting your own right and maybe stealing a point from the other person, if that makes sense.
Okay, I like the sound of this.
So it's a little bit like your... what was it? Your underground station's pronunciation game. But it's based around slang from your region. So getting your own one right, that's where you want to focus. If you can maybe pinch and get another one right from somewhere else, if you can have a good guess, then that's where you're going to win.
Are we going home and away? Or are we? Is there a points differential? Or is it just if the person gets it wrong, then you can steal?
So basically, well... All it is going to be is if you get it right, you get a point. That's the only the way I've got of working it. But at the same time, I want to make it so that if you're... Because I'm going to do it region by region. So if it's yours, you answer last, because you're going to be giving clues away. Because if it's in yours and you guess first, or you give the correct answer first, you're going to be giving it away, surely. So that person goes last.
Okay. I like the sound of it. So, are you back?
Yeah, don't worry about explaining the rules again. I'll fly blind.
Okay. Well, I'm no wiser any either, so.
Okay. So, it's slang, basically. So, guess the slang word. Get the slang word correctly, you get a point. So, I'm going to start with Rich, because I've had to split it over two areas. So, you've lived in LA quite a while, right? Quite a long time.
Yes.
Okay. So, I wanted to make it entirely sort of Pittsburgh-based slang, but I think because we've all got an awareness of the city and the team or have you, that we've sort of all picked up an amount of the slang.
You have to feel that Rich has an advantage there, though, being born
and raised. Well, this is it. Well, there's going to be a northern slang and a London slang.
Hmm.
So you're going to have the advantage in your area, and it's going to be everyone else's disadvantage. Yeah. You've got to take advantage of your region.
I don't think we could have all done like Mongolian slang and made it fair. Like that would have been
Pretty no, difficult. But that would have been some heavy research. I don't have time for that. So I've basically for the US section, I've split it between LA and some Pittsburgh slang that I think you might not know. Okay.
Sure.
So for this first round, Rich will be answering last, and it'll be between Cy and Gav, whoever wants to have a guess first.
So you're not playing, right? Of course you are.
I'm entirely.
You're the games master.
Yes, and if are you keeping score?
I've got it. I've got yeah. I'm ready.
Okay. So the first one is NoHo. It's an LA. I should say these first ones will be LA ones, and this first one is NoHo.
What's the question? NoHo is what?
NoHo.
That's a play on Soho.
That's
right?
What I thought. I thought the same thing. But what does it mean? So is it like off Broadway? Is it like an off Soho? I don't know. Like, but this is American, so
is it not an area?
They have a Soho. They don't have a Soho. So, or do they? No, they don't.
I've definitely heard this before, but I can't.
No.
Is it not an area down like outside of downtown? I don't know. What's the format here? Are you just waiting for the first correct answer?
I'm going to need final answers out of each of you. But Rich will be going last.
So I'm waiting. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
Wait. So we have to have a definitive guess.
Yes.
Is that what you're saying? Okay.
Yes, you have to give an answer to the question he's asked. Why do we have to... We have to, like, deliberate every single thing in all these quizzes. It's like...
Well, no, Dave just said a word. I'm unclear of what the format was. Am I saying something, or am I discussing it with Si?
Okay, what is, each of you, an answer for what is NoHo?
So almost like fastest fingers first, apart from Rich, who's not allowed to answer for some reason.
Well, I feel that him answering first would be an unfair advantage on...
Okay. So just to make the rules clear. So you're nominating someone that can't answer, and then between the other two, they have a chance to answer first. Because if Si says anything, I'm going to go, I'm going with that.
Sure, I guess. But I mean, Rich might not know the answer.
Well, right, I'll tell you what, Gav, we'll rotate like who this. Goes first. So you go first, then next time I go first. So then you go first, and then I go first.
I like the predetermined person who should know, who can't answer, who's getting frustrated, like, you idiots. I like this. This is a new format, Dave, you've come up with.
And I'm getting frustrated about the deliberation of the rules.
It's not going to be a game show anytime soon.
Okay, it's we call it, yeah, the he who should know. I'm going to go NoHo as being, yeah, like an area. So is that not specific enough? Somewhere outside of downtown. I don't know.
Yeah,
that's what I've got.
I want to say that it's like, I don't know, like the Pittsburgh's theatre district or something like that.
Okay. Well, this one is LA based.
Oh, well, it's definitely not that then.
LA.
Yeah, well, I was going to LA, like outside of, I don't know, between, like, just you go past downtown, you go past Chinatown, there somewhere.
So, okay, so we have a guess.
Before you get to Silver Lake.
We have a guess of outside of downtown. What is Si's guess?
I don't know. I haven't got a clue. let Rich put me out of my misery.
We have a pass. What is if you know Rich, what is NoHo?
I think it's North Hollywood.
Oh,
it is North Hollywood.
It is. The trouble is I was so hooked up on the Soho thing.
So wait, is North Hollywood an area just outside of downtown?
I suppose it is.
It's all part of LA County. Los Angeles is spread out huge, so I don't know. I honestly don't know the answer to that.
I'd say it's close.
I think it's about intent. Point? What was your intent?
I did say it was an area. I said it was an area, and I knew it was like a physical location.
Look at this. Gav skirted the lines. Everyone knew it was a physical location.
Here's the thing, though. With that line of reasoning, it could have been another city north of Los Angeles, so you would get multiple guesses instead of having to guess the exact city.
I said it was. It could have been outside of.
It could have been Thousand Oaks. So you're able to be right with a lot of different guesses.
Where... I said it was just outside of downtown LA.
I know, but there's a lot of places just outside of downtown LA.
But I'm just outside. No, I'm just outside that area.
I was shooting blank. It could have been anything. I guessed it was a geographic. All right, I'll go with zero. I'll accept it. But I'm just saying it wasn't a bad guess.
Okay. It's fine with me. Leave it up to Dave. It's his game.
True.
Okay, well, I'm going to say no points for that one because I think Richie's right on. It could have been a whole lot of areas.
Okay,
It could have been a lot of areas that could. Okay, well, we've got a lot to get through, so let's get moving. Jeez,
it wouldn't be this podcast if there wasn't a rule discussion.
Okay, the next one is also an LA one, and what is a grip?
Is that like a grip or a grip? Like, is it one word or?
G-R-I-P.
Okay. Grip. Grip.
Go on, Si. I went first last time.
Damn, yeah, of course you did. grip. It's something to do with the earthquake defences for when it all slides into the sea.
I like that.
It's gripping the buildings to the floor.
All right. It's creative.
Okay, I'm going to go with the film technician that deals with camera mounting and lighting.
That feels unfair.
Okay, so Rich, what is a grip?
That is what Gavin said. That is my guess as well. That's the only grip that I know of in LA.
Okay, so I have a grip meaning like a lot, like loads of.
Hmm. Oh wow! Oh okay.
Like a grip of hot dogs.
That's something you could have a lot of, yeah.
I didn't know that one.
A grip of money. I mean, maybe we have to like cross references and get them checked they're right. But as from my research, a grip means a lot.
Donuts all round. Okay.
Okay. Next one.
Technically, me and Rich were correct, but it's a pass on that. Quizmaster, you. It's fine.
That's not slang. That's just a thing that is.
It's the thing in Hollywood as well, though. I mean, it's like a... Anyway, all right, fine. Okay. I'm not going to... Whatever.
Next one.
Quick name.
Round three.
Next one. Finna. F-I-N-N-A. Finna. I'm trying to do the accent, but I can't do it.
I know this one, so I'll let Gav go.
What region is this from?
Also LA.
Oh, okay. I think I know this.
We'll let Gav go because I know this one, so I'm testing him here.
I don't know this one at all. So finna. I'm gonna go with the type of sandwich.
I like that. So as far as I'm aware, it's just a synonym for gunner. So I'm finna blast you up, bro. That's a thing someone would say.
Yeah, that's my answer. That's what I believe it is.
Yeah, fixing to, going to. Yeah, finna.
Yeah,
that's correct.
Millennials, screw you guys.
So is that a point for Si and for Rich?
Does Si
steal the point because he got it right first?
No. They each get a point. I'm basically putting the person whose area these slang words are from last because it would give an unfair advantage to everyone else.
This is an honor system.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Because if say for Finna, Rich says, oh, it's fixing to, going to, everyone else gives the same answer, and it becomes a bit of a non-quiz.
Understood.
Yeah. So the last LA one, before we move on to Pittsburgh, is June Gloom. J-U-N-E, as in the month. June Gloom.
So I think, I could be wrong about this, but I think that like in this area of the country, it's like more rainy and cold in June than it is in like the winter. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but is that why? Is that why they say it's like June gloom because it's like the only time they get rain or something, or the weather's bad?
Is that your answer?
Yeah.
I'm gonna go with sunburn.
Ooh.
Rich, what is June gloom?
It's like cloudy or overcast skies, like basically what Simon said.
Yeah, it's a weather sort of weather phenomenon that happens around June where it becomes pretty gloomy in LA.
Points all round for everyone except me. Okay, round five.
I thought you were going to claim that then for sunburn.
No. I know when I'm beat.
Okay, we're moving on to the Pittsburgh region.
Okay.
Okay, so the next one is Nebby. N-E-B-B-Y. Nebby.
Is this for someone who's a little bit annoyed?
Is that your answer?
Yes.
Okay.
Nebby. I'm going to say it's like your community, your neighbourhood. This is my Nebby. Get out of my Nebby. Okay. I'll use it in a sentence.
Rich?
Nebby is like someone who's getting in your business. Like it's not their business, but they're getting, you know, like, you know, somebody putting their nose in what your business is. I don't know. That's the best I can explain it.
Someone who's a bit too nosy. Yeah. Being Nebby.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Rich got one and we got zero.
Yeah. But this is where the you know, get your own ones right thing comes in.
The pendulum will swing.
I kind of knew that was about someone. I'm giving myself a pat on the back. But
I'm giving myself a quarter of a point there.
Yeah. Gav's got the real moral victory on this game, I got to say.
Okay, next one. Red up.
Red
up. R-E-D-U-P. Red up.
I went last, sorry. Over to you.
Red up. Oh! Is it the what's the name of it? The thing that goes up the mountain on the side. Rich, help me out.
The trolley.
Yeah,
the
is it that? That's kind
I'm
of red, right?
It's not that.
No, probably not.
I'm gonna say it's like tricky.
It's tricky.
Yeah, it's tricky. Red up, and so you have got revenge over someone.
Okay, Rich.
It sounds like that makes that actually makes sense. Red up is like cleaning, up the house, cleaning something.
Yeah, that's what my research has brought up. Red up is like tidying up the house.
Oh, I wonder what the etymology of that is. Why is it red?
Is it red or read up?
No, it's red up.
Is it red up?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Like you've read up. I don't know.
Maybe there's a bit of that to it, yeah. Bit of re up. Yeah, maybe. Improving, yeah. The final one from the US based part of this quiz is pop.
P-O-P?
Pop. Yes.
That's. Like a soft drink, cola.
Yeah, that's soda in Pittsburgh, isn't it?
Yep, that's soda. I still used to call it pop when I first moved out here. Everybody look at me weird.
Yeah, I felt that one was a bit of a gimme. I think everyone deserved a bit of a break after some hard ones, I thought.
Yeah, definitely got me off the zeros.
Off the schneid.
Yeah.
Hey, what's snide? That's a good one.
The thing is, like you said, I was brought up saying pop as well, and I had to stop myself from saying it when I go into restaurants. My instinct is to say, oh, I have a pop. And then they go, oh, which pop do you want? And most of them just look at you going, what the fuck is pop?
Yeah, I never liked it as a word, to be honest.
I'm just glad I've read up my scoring chart here. Right, who's next?
Okay. What's up? So we're going on to now the Northern English section.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. A-up. So this is, and this part, A up, Si will be going last.
A up, Chuck.
So both Gav and Rich will be answering first, alternating between the two of you, however you see fit. Okay, so the first one is marred, M-A-R-D, marred.
I'll let Rich go first.
Jeez. I'll say when something is flawed or damaged.
I'm going to say, I know it is mardy, you're in a slightly bad mood, like you're a little bit ticked off.
Yeah, I think that's what Dave's going for, but I would say mardy, but I agree with you, Gav, but I don't know, maybe it's like the singular version of that word. Is that what you mean, Dave?
To my understanding, marred means you're a bit of a wimp.
I'm not familiar with that.
Oh, ard, zeros all round.
Ard, not marred, as the saying goes.
Oh, no. No, I agree. I thought you meant mardy as well.
Yeah. Oh, what, so like you're like
instead of nout, you've got out, you've got hard and marred. All right, fine.
I suppose. But I understand that it can be used in different ways across across North English regions. But from my understanding of marred, it is that you're pretty soft.
Sissy.
Spoiled, soft. Sulky, sullen, having tantrum, being difficult. I've just Urban Dictionary in it.
So maybe that's the second one,
a person who is generally a drip. So maybe both. Interested.
He's a mard. So maybe that's where mardy comes from. You're annoyed at being a mard.
Mm. Okay.
Okay.
So anyone get points on that one? Have we assigned points?
No, that was donuts all round.
Okay. Okay. So the next one is Nesh. NESH.
This Nesh. Is one that Lisa accuses me of being all the time. So let's, Rich, go first.
Stab in the dark.
I'm just wondering how my answer is going to affect Gavin, because now I know he's being accused of this.
It's wrong, by the way. She's absolutely wrong. She knows it winds me up when she calls me it.
Okay, I'll say being cheap.
Whoa.
Nice well, you said she's wrong.
It's basically like being a softy southerner, isn't it? It's like wanting to taking offense at things that don't deserve to take offense at, and being like a kind of stuck up posh guy.
What was did Si give an answer?
I've never heard this word in my entire life.
Okay. That's
okay. It's not going well for me.
my understanding. I mean, I suppose you're kind of right in it, Gav. But like to me, Nesh means that if you're outdoors and it starts raining, you start whinging straight away. You're afraid of the elements.
Yeah. Softy southerner. Yeah.
Yeah, you're softy. So like marred and Nesh are sort of interchangeable, but Nesh sort of is related more to being just sort of whinging constantly.
Moany.
I don't know what area of the north this is, but I never heard of these.
that's Yorkshire. That is. She accuses me of being Nesh once a week. I moan about the potatoes. Stop being Nesh.
Just pull my own headphones off my ears. Just losing it over
that's
it.
That's hard. I'm okay. I'll give myself a point there, Dave.
Yeah, I think that's worth a point.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. Next one. Put wood in the hole. It's not what you think it is. Put wood in the hole. Or put wood in the hole.
I mean, it sounds like putting one on the fire. I've not heard this one. I'll go first. Or it could be like plugging a dam. So it could be like problem solving. So I'm going to go with shut up and put up. Solve the problem.
Problem solving, okay.
Yeah, stop whinging. Solve the problem.
I think a lot of northern slang comes back to telling people to stop whinging.
Yeah. Rich?
I'm going to guess it's just basically telling someone to shut up.
Okay.
So the first thing, I've still never heard of this. The first thing I thought was what Gav said, that it is literally just put wood in the fire.
So they put wood in thole is shut the door.
Oh.
Put wood in the hole. You're letting your side down here, Si.
Am I, Dave, or is this questionable selection of northern
slang? To be fair, I've picked some hard ones.
These are tough, man.
I can't go for the easy ones. I thought I've got to pick the hard ones where I can.
I have always said, though, I think Bolton is like a weird little place where they don't necessarily follow all the rules of other northern towns. Yeah.
It's not the north.
We have our own little brand of words and stuff. Yeah, sorry, go on.
Next one is belting.
Oh, now that was easy, so I was surprised at the grunt there.
Well, there's a couple. Let Rich go first. Oh, do you want me to go first? I don't know. Who's up?
It doesn't
Rich
matter to me.
Belting.
Belting. B-E-L-T-I-N-G?
Yes.
I would say that's doing something in great abundance.
Okay.
I'd go proper wicked. It's wicked.
That's a belting couple. That's a belting couple of.
It's massive.
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah,
it's
if something's really good, it's belting.
Yeah.
So is that a point for me, Ansai? And
yes, although wicked in itself is a cloak.
But that, I'd say wicked and belting were interchangeable.
Yeah. This is another tough one. I feel kind of bad now. I'm looking back at these and thinking, that's a hard one. That's a hard one. A ginnel.
I know this.
Yeah.
It's a ginnel.
So, Rich, go first.
A ginnel.
That's tough, Dave.
Is that
for a Pittsburghian?
Now, do you call this something different down south, Gav, without saying what it is? Do you
Definitely. But you've got to remember, my mum's from Lancashire as well. So I have been exposed to some of these terms. And my missus as well, yeah.
I'll say it's a beer. It's a term for a beer.
Now, do you call this a snicket, Gav?
I'd say the alternate is a snicket.
Yeah.
But I would call it an alley.
Yeah, I'd call it a ginnel. Yeah.
It's an alleyway between two terraces, two rows of terrace houses. They face outwards from each other, and the alley between them is the ginnel.
Ooh, I was close.
You're very close. Yeah. If you really squint really hard, you're really close.
Gav would have got a point for that, Rich.
I don't.
Okay, another tough one. Striking.
Say that again, sorry?
Say it.
Striking.
With a K, like S-K?
You could, yeah, S-K-R-I-K-I-N-G. Okay. Striking.
I'll go first. Is it when your tool is broken and you're hitting it with a blunt? So like you're trying to do something, but you're failing.
Okay. Striking.
Oh my gosh.
Tough, isn't it?
Wow. I
feel like I may have made the section too hard.
Striking. I'll say that's another word for hitting something, a ball or whatever, just hitting.
Okay. Any guesses, Si?
I've never heard this word before.
Okay. It's very suitable for my household right now. Striking is crying very loudly.
Oh.
The final one for the northern section, you'll all be glad to hear, is about to be over.
like the cancelled HS2 section. No one wishes it ever happened.
So the last one for the northern section is, it's cracking the flags. What does it mean? If someone says, it's cracking the flags,
it's cracking.
What's going on?
Cracking the flags.
I think this is more a nationwide term. I think this is used elsewhere outside of the north, to be honest with you.
Nationwide in Yorkshire.
I think all these have been nationwide in Dave's house.
I've made cracking all the flags.
Is that like my initial reaction is it's gone way over the top.
Okay.
I'll say severe weather conditions.
Yeah, I kind of thought that. Like it's really freezing. Like, oh, it's cracking the flags.
Wind blowing. Yeah, that's a good guess.
Are they your final answers?
Yeah.
So if it's cracking the flags, it is so hot.
Oh, it's the opposite.
That it's breaking up the ground. If the earth gets really scorched, it breaks open.
It sounds to me like something that someone from Cheshire who worked in the groundskeeping game would play. Say, which is funny.
Are you implying that I've had sway in this quiz that I've made up myself?
Perhaps.
Okay, I said severe weather conditions.
I think he deserves a point for that. I think
really,
considering he knows little to nothing about British slang, I think that's a good guess.
All right.
Thank you, Dave.
Right, round 15. We're on to my section.
Yes,
great.
But I've stayed away from Cockney rhyming slang because I hate
that's
the stuff.
Too bizarre. Yeah.
So I've gone with more modern London slang. So we're going to start with have a banana. No, we're not going to have a banana. what is have a banana anyway? I say that to take Mick out of Cockneys. You go, have a banana. What was it all about?
No one really says that. That's like from 80s TV shows. Anyway, all right, fine.
Chimney sweep and all that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the first one is bear. B-A-R-E, bear.
Dave, I love you.
Bear.
I'm not going first. This is my category.
It is your category.
Like a big hairy gay man.
B A R E, not that. not wrong. Get out of that area of London. Take a left.
I'm not in Soho anymore.
Get on the tube. Go to a different part of London. Not that part. B A R E.
Oh, so you mean? I'll go after Rich then because I think I know it. Sorry, I'm with you with the spelling. I follow.
Is it like not very many of, not a very big number?
Okay.
I think it's actually the opposite, right? It's bear. I've got loads. I got bear time on my hands.
Okay.
Yeah, like you got bear questions wrong in this.
Yeah, so. Yeah. That's funny though, Rich, that you like because you were on the right track. You just it was the opposite.
Yeah, you were. Yeah.
Okay. I was thinking like the bear cupboards.
Yeah, that's probably right. Why is it the opposite of that?
Very little sense.
Bear things to say. Yeah.
As London slang generally is, it makes very little sense.
So what we're saying there, obviously I got that one right, but has Si got that right? I think he did, didn't he?
Yes. Yeah, he did. Yeah.
Got better
points. Next one. I'm going to try and do it in a London accent because it sounds better. Butters. Butters. Or butters. Butters.
Are you saying butters, like B-U-T-T-E-R?
Butters, mate.
Butters.
I'm not even going to say the word that usually goes in front of it because that'll give it a clue.
Bart? How do you spell that?
Butters.
B-U-T-T-E-R-S. As in...
Oh, butters. On toast. Oh, butters.
Butters.
Okay. Butters.
I know the etymology of this one too.
I don't know this one, so I can go first if you want, Rich.
It doesn't matter. I don't know it either.
Butters. I'm trying to think like something slippy.
Butters.
No.
Butters.
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 So I reckon that's like sneaking on the tube without paying.
Okay, I like that guess.
Good guess.
Butters. People that are like nasty, mean, ornery.
What? But no cigar. She's Butters, mate. She's absolutely Butters.
It comes from
she's butterfaced, as in she's really fit except butterface. Everything butterface. Yeah.
Butters. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a term out here, butterface. I haven't heard it in a while though.
Yeah. So Butters.
If there's any women listening, I apologize.
Well, it could be a man. He's totally a stud, Butters face.
Isn't that called a prawn?
Is that so?
Nice body, but ugly face. That's a prawn, I think. Okay, next one. I'm gonna do the rest of them in as best I can in a London
gangster. I'm enjoying this round a lot more than the other ones. I'll tell you that.
I didn't like my round.
You can send all complaints, put them all on a piece of paper and just chuck them out the window.
After Rich knew all of his, when you said the Northern round, I was like, right, yes, I'm going to know all these.
Okay, the next one, chirpsin.
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 It's funny because these are all quite old, but it makes me wonder if the Northern ones and the LA/Pittsburgh ones were old too.
I thought these were all quite new. I've not heard
them. Not so far.
Is it like where chirping came from in hockey when you chirp someone? I don't know. I'll go with that. I'll go. It means to annoy someone or joke with someone, make fun of them, something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, is it chirpsing on? It's like someone who's like, you know, running their mouth who shouldn't be.
Okay.
Close, but no cigar. It's chatting up a bird. It's talking to a lady in terms of trying to get into a bed.
Chirpsing gal.
Chirpsing enough gal dim. Yeah.
Why do all Londoners speak like they're like 17-year-old black men? You know what I mean? Like, why is that?
Because we have that culture within us. I hold it back on the podcast, but it's there.
Okay. It's like, have you seen that Google advert where the guy walks up to the three guys in the street corner and goes, is it okay to say wagwam? Have you seen that advert? It's terrible.
Wagwam? No, it's definitely not all right to say
no,
wagwam.
No, that's an advert. Have you seen him?
He doesn't say wagwan. He doesn't say wagwam.
What's the difference between those two words? I thought it was the same word.
There's a massive difference. If you say wagwam to people, then
right,
you're going to get
okay,
laughed out.
Okay, see, this is what I'm talking about, because apparently I've just accidentally uttered a slur, but this is what I'm saying. Why is...
Just to be clear, I wouldn't say either, but if I was going to say one, I definitely wouldn't say wagwam.
I literally did not know they were two different words. I thought that was the same thing.
Because one's a Caribbean-influenced wagwan, and one's wagwam. They're very clearly different.
What does wagwam mean?
What?
What?
So wagwam is a kind of teepee that Native Americans live
right,
in.
Right, okay, that's not what I was referring to. I was referring to wagwam then. But what I'm saying is, there's an advert that Google put out.
Yeah.
It's like a guy going up to
Is it okay to say wagwan?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's different. That's a different cultural
all right,
appropriation
well, forget the,
question.
Forget the Native American thing, because I didn't know that was a thing. But the wagwan thing, apparently, because they're like, yeah, it's okay to say wagwan.
It's not wagwan. It's not wagwan. You can't say wagwan.
Right, what am I... Dave, what am I saying?
I don't know what you're saying.
It's wagwan. Like, what's guan?
I feel like
wagwan.
This is a pronunciation issue. And
yeah, it is pronunciation,
Gav's
but you definitely cannot
like,
say wagwan.
Yeah,
like, that's
like, yeah,
so wrong.
Wagwan's like a yardie thing, right? That's like
what?
A Jamaican patois thing.
We can't have things that are the exact same word, but you say them differently, and that's whether or not
it's
a slur.
Yeah, all right. It's potentially offensive for a white person to go up to a black person and say wagwan.
But there's a commercial where
it's
he's doing
comical
it.
To go up to a black person as a white person and say wagwan.
But my point
that's
was,
like,
the advert is so ridiculous.
I'm so far removed from your culture, I don't even know what's going on here. But yeah, I'm trying. I'm really trying. I've come down on a day trip from York. Please humour me.
Oh, look at this. Look, Gav missed a culture because he lives in London. You know,
sorry,
he knows everyone. Sorry, he knows
sorry.
All the cultural slang.
I was
oh, jeez. Yeah, God.
I thought a TP was wigwam.
Yeah. Hey, TP, my brother. What's happening?
Oh, for God's sake. I think he's more offensive than me.
I got accused of being offensive today, so I am a little bit butthurt. So, yeah, I'm sorry. Okay. Sorry, Simon. I'm just poking fun.
I think it's just best that none of us go up to anyone and say, well,
yeah, I wouldn't do it.
Next one is fam. F-A-M. Fam.
Surely that's worldwide.
Yeah.
Go on then, Simon. You seem confident.
Is it worldwide?
Let Rich, because I feel like I know that.
The one fam that I know is family. That's your family.
Yeah, like, what's
the
up, fam?
Fam?
Like, it doesn't necessarily have to be, like, your actual family, but, yeah, what's up, fam?
I'd say it's closer to, like, bro.
Yeah. It's like...
Yeah,
but
friends, close
yeah,
friends.
Exactly.
Yeah, family, close friends. Yeah. Another, I thought, a gimme. But then I didn't put a gimme in the northern section.
No,
okay. I'm sorry, Si. Maybe you should put that on your complaints list.
It's a little bit southern-centric.
Okay.
Or northern-centric. You're trying to rob me of points. Maybe.
Maybe. The next one.
Fam.
Hench.
Okay, I know that one, so.
Spelled in the same way as henchman. Hench.
Rich?
Hench. Could it come from henchman? Somebody who breaks the law. I don't know.
Okay.
Hench is like buff. Looking hench.
Oh, I had no idea. Oh.
Get hench or die trying.
bit like me.
I've said that on this podcast. Surely I say that all the time, don't I?
I'm sure we all say things all the time that Rich doesn't understand. And he just smiles.
Oh, I just
glosses over.
Yeah, I just ignore it.
I'm pretty sure I say get hints on or die trying pretty much every other podcast. But okay, fine.
Okay.
Now you understand the context, Rich. There we go. This quiz is enriching us all.
Awesome. The next one was going to be Galdem, but you gave away what Galdem was.
Did I? I'm not sure I did.
I think you said it.
I said it. I'm not sure I gave away the meaning, but
I've changed it.
Okay.
I've changed it. The next one will be Lipsin.
Lipsin.
Lipsin. L-I-P-S-I-N.
I think I'm going to go with that's like bluffing, like bravado.
These are tough ones, to be fair.
lips. Whistling.
Okay.
It's your lips whistling. I don't know.
Mm. To be fair, you do whistle with your lips.
Mm.
Now, if you're eyeing something up, it's because you want it, right? But what if lipsing is like you want someone's sandwich? Oh, I'm lipsing for that sandwich. Is that a thing?
I'm going to say talking about someone.
Okay, well, lipsing gal then. Kissing.
That's the other option, kissing.
Mm.
I nearly said that.
Well, you use your lip. No, I'm not going to go for that. No, I'm not going to push that.
Yeah. Don't go there.
Well, you do.
Don't go there. Yours was worse.
I've heard about what goes on in LA. The last one. The final one, you'll all be glad to hear, so you can all go home, is peng.
Oh. Yeah.
But I've heard of two meanings of peng, but one of them is a northern meaning of peng, but I don't know if it's what it means in the south. So it'd be interesting to see the difference.
Okay.
But peng.
Which?
Peng.
P-E-N-G, peng. Welcome to the Dead Air podcast.
honestly, I don't even have a guess for this
one. It totally makes sense. Like, if I'd never heard anyone say peng and someone's like, what's peng? I'd be like, I don't know. It doesn't even sound like anything, does it? It's one of those stupid slang words. It doesn't mean anything.
The Lewisham supporters Steelers club going mad right now.
To be fair.
Bruv, how can you not know what peng is?
To be fair, red up. How are you supposed to know what red up means?
Yeah, that's true, I suppose. Hazard a guess, Rich? Or are you passing?
I have no idea. Okay. I don't even have a guess.
Well,
okay.
There's that kid in London, right? Who reviews fried chicken. He's like, this fried chicken is peng. It's like, it's good.
Good. You're going with good. Okay.
Well,
that's a loose definition.
Well, I mean, what do you want? I mean, that's what it is, isn't it? It's peng. It's nice. It's tasty. I don't
define it
food,
as
but...
you're going to a wedding. You put on your best suit. You look in the mirror and go, I look peng in this.
This guy describes fried chicken as peng. How can it be dressed
but
in a suit?
That's it. That's a loose definition. I'd say it's specifically you look above and beyond.
I don't buy that.
It's a descriptive.
It is a look thing. Yeah, you're right.
It's a look thing. It's like, I look peng.
You're right.
It can't taste peng. It can't be peng. You look peng. Like, it's like... James Bond always looks peng.
But chicken can look peng.
The definition I have as peng is good looking. A good looking person or a thing that is good looking.
Yeah. Okay. It's like you've maxed out. You've scrubbed up to the best level.
Yeah. Okay. I'm with you. Because they describe women as peng down there, don't they?
Well, I've also heard peng described as something that you would put into a jazz cigarette.
Oh, I've not heard that one.
Maybe that's more of a local thing.
Is that the northern one you were talking about?
Yeah, I think maybe it has another mix, but maybe it's just something that I've heard on my travels.
So when you go up to your Jamaican quartet of buddies and go, hey, wagwan,
hey,
I want some peng. See how that goes. I've got bear peng.
And the four gentlemen will look at me and say, we're just on our lunch breaks from Barclays, like, leave me alone.
Yeah.
Yo, fam, you buzz.
You racist bastard.
Just trying to do what the Google ad told me, Gav. This is where I ended up.
I would just steer clear of any cultural sayings.
Yeah, but this is
I've won this quiz, but I don't believe it. I have.
What
I've won
surprise.
This quiz.
What a shocker. Gav, who didn't get any questions right until halfway through the quiz, has suddenly won in a shocking turn of events.
you two have tied at 8 and I got 10.
I just don't believe it, do you, Dave? Something seems off about that altogether.
It does seem off.
We've left Gav with a score and he's given himself points for all manner of things that we didn't agree with.
On the win-loss ratio, I think Rich is winning most quiz slash, sort of... you know, most answer-based things. So, you know.
I did go on a streak from question 15 through question 19, which I think won the thing.
I will say that the London ones seem more... Like, I knew more London ones than the bloody Northern ones.
Mm. Maybe that shows the way modern times are moving. You didn't know what putting wood in thole is.
But I wouldn't say any of them, though. They're kind of like things that I laugh at Southerners for saying, you know?
I wouldn't say peng in daily life, to be honest.
Nah. But, it's kind of a northern thing, because I call the TV the box, and I keep getting called old-fashioned for it. But,
what's on the box tonight, love?
Yeah, what's on the box? I'm going to put the box on. But I get laughed at it for it. But that's what I was brought up calling it. And the zapper, the TV remote, the zapper.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah. One of my good friends, their family always called it the press it. Ooh. Pass the press it.
I suppose it makes sense because you press the buttons.
Yeah.
That was a good one, Dave.
Yeah, it was a good one. Well done.
Now I've got a billion northern slang words that I want to test, but we'll save that. Maybe I'll do a northern slang thing one day.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully you've all played along at home a little bit, and maybe you've learnt some things. Maybe you've learnt what lipsin is and galdem and what you shouldn't say around certain people in London boroughs. You know.
What was galdem? We never really defined what that is.
Galdem's like women generally, right?
Like the opposite of mandem.
Mandem and galdem. Lips and galdem. Chirps and galdem.
Just better hope they're not butters in.
I just hope they're not butters, yeah.
Right, let's wrap it up.
Have a banana.
That must be the longest kebab corner we've ever done. How long was that? That was like an hour and a half.
No, I think we're on 4 hours now, right?
Yeah, I know. Everyone's gonna be like, oh, wow, how did you do a 3-hour show on that game? I'd be like, we didn't. Right, follow the show.
It's that woo woo.
I tell you what, though, the Ravens podcast does not have that.
No, probably not. No, and that, probably
that would
for the
be edited down. Yeah, edited down to a tight 15 minutes. But you'd lose something. What you gain, you'd lose.
Yeah, you gain listeners, but you'd lose something. That's for sure.
We don't want the listeners we'd gain. We want to keep the listeners we'd lose. So
yeah,
we love the ones we have.
That's true. Okay. Oh, yeah, thank you for everyone sending the Spotify Wrapped in. I know I jumped about at the top, but with us on it because they do podcasts and they show, like, your top podcasts, and we were on a few, so that was nice.
Oh, really? What's this? I don't know anything about this.
You know, Spotify, they send, like, your Wrapped thing at the end of the year, and it shows you how many minutes you've listened to music and what your top artists were and blah, 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 blah. Well, today was Wrapped Day, as it's become, and they do podcasts, obviously, so a lot of people listen to us on Spotify, and they were sending in, like, us on the list. We came in second on a few people behind around the NFL. Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Thanks, guys. Keep it up. Let's just be number one. Let's keep on pushing.
Yeah. Screw Dan Hanses. Get us to one. The shows are long enough, goddammit. Right. Follow the show at UK Steelers Pod. Follow me at Cy Wrote This. Follow Gav at GM Boom Up. And follow Dave at This Is Dave Hart on Twitter. And follow Rich at Stunt_Batman on Instagram. And we'll see you next week at... Well, I'm not even going to pretend that the record's going to be whatever it is. But let's just hope we don't get blown out.
See you later.
See ya.
Cheers, guys.
Go Steelers.